co-champions of the Big Sky. But tonight's rematch showdown carries an elevated significance as the Big Sky co-coaches of the year go head-to-head for a chance to advance to the national semifinal of the FCS playoff. UC Davis and Eastern Washington next. Welcome to the quarterfinals of the NCAA FCS Championship. We're in Cheney, Washington, the Inferno Ruse Field, the site as the UC Davis Aggies meet the Eastern Washington Eagles. A look at the bracket. The winner here advances to the FCS semifinals to host the Maine Black Bears, upset winners over Weber State. That game will be next weekend. Hi, everybody. I'm Trey Bender alongside the former Florida State offensive lineman, Forrest Connolly. Glad you're with us. Two of the top FCS offenses, a rematch for Big Sky co-champs. A lot more at stake here. Both these teams run no-huddle offenses. Put your seatbelts on.
Well, for UC Davis, they lost this ball game the last time these teams faced. And when you talk about losing, you always say, if we had another opportunity to play them, we would win that football game. Well, they get that opportunity this afternoon, and the stakes are much higher.
Jake Mayer, a sensational season for the Aggies, the Big Sky Offensive Player of the Year.
Well, Jake Mayer is the alpha dog for this offense for UC Davis. He will have to do a very good job with his pre-snap reads because they're going to bring pressure. They want to force him outside of the pocket, get him out of his comfort zone. So he has to have a big game this afternoon.
Now you've got a versatile guy in Eric Berrier on the other side taking over for the injured All-American Gage Gubrud midseason. He can do a lot of things well.
Well, for Eric Berrier, what he brings to the table is an ability to run the football effectively. Over 500 yards rushing the football. That dual threat ability helps this ball club. And you talk about Gage Gubrud being out. I think he helped both quarterbacks. When you look at Jake Mayer now winning the conference offensive player of the year and Berrier coming in and becoming the guy moving forward, you look at both of these quarterbacks, it's going to be a great matchup.
The Eagles and the Aggies, postseason football. Eagles have won the previous seven, including a big 59-20 win here November 10th. We'll kick it off next. Trip to the semifinals on the line from Cheney, Washington. Chilly here in early December in the Pacific Northwest. Eastern Washington and UC Davis, the Eagles, a playoff fixture, 13 FCS trips. This is the first FCS playoff for UC Davis, their first road playoff game under Dan Hawkins. What a job he's done. In his second season, he's coached at several different levels, has taken this program to new heights. And Aaron Best, his first playoff trip as a head coach, 22-year vet of the Eagles program. Both Big Sky co-coaches of the year and a great atmosphere here. They know about good football in this part of the country.
Well, for UC Davis, it's an opportunity to right their wrong. They felt like they had an opportunity to win the ball game here. They had an early 10-point lead. It got away from them, so they want to jump out early. They know they can score. They've got to maintain the scoring, and defensively, they've got to stand up to this high-powered offense from Eastern Washington.
Andre Slider, sophomore from Kent, Washington, to kick it away on the red turf here, the Inferno, as we get underway here in the quarterfinal. The winner will meet the Maine Black Bears. Namani Modise will field this at the 3-yard line. He's their threat as a return guy across the 25, and he's run out of bounds at the 32-yard line. A dynamic offense. Key is don't turn it over. They had 5 in the last meeting, and Jake Mayer can make all the throws. Has had an incredible season, 3rd in the FCS in passing yardage.
Well, for Jake Mayer, he has to do a very good job with his pre-snap reads. I expect the Eastern Washington defense to move around. They want to confuse the offensive lineman for UC Davis. They want to make Jake Mayer think a little bit prior to the snap of the football.
6 300-yard games for Mayer. He's a Peyton Award candidate, along with Keelan Doss, who will keep a close eye on arguably the best receiver at the FCS level. They'll run it on first down with Ulonzo Gilliam, the redshirt freshman, and he navigates the middle of the field and picks up a couple impact players.
Well, for UC Davis, Keelan Doss, he can play all of the wide receiver positions. What continues to stand out is his ability to gain yards after the catch. He's a tough runner, and what I love about him is his willingness to go across the middle.
And there is Doss on cue, and he has a first down catch up to the 44-yard line. Josh Lewis, the corner, on the stop. He beats you in a lot of different ways, number three.
Well, the thing about Doss, he's a taller receiver at 6'3", and usually guys that tall don't like to go across the middle. He's a tough guy, and you cannot scheme him for one particular thing. He does everything well from the wide receiver position.
Two-time All-American, as Mayer looks to the sideline for the call here. They'd ideally like to snap it within 15 seconds every time they come to the line of scrimmage, taking a little bit more time here. Initial series, fresh set of downs to the 45-yard line. Handoff, Gilliam right up the gut, has a first down into Eagles territory and down to the 43-yard line. DeJonte Hayes, the junior safety, on the tackle.
And the other impact player on the other side of the football is JT Tiuli. He is a true zero technique, size 6'4", 320. Can he control the line of scrimmage and occupy two offensive linemen to allow the linebackers to flow downhill to the ball carrier?
Look at the time for Mayer. Now he'll roll right, going to tuck it, and he's hit hard and dropped for a loss. A flag will come in here. That was Kettner Cup, the senior, their leading tackler. He got some help from Chris Ojo, but may have been leading with the headgear on that one.
Well, also, when a quarterback slides feet first, you have to lay off because he is down when he slides feet first. If he would have dived forward, then he could have been hit by the defender without a penalty being called.
Bob Johnson, our lead referee here.
Personal foul. Targeting. Number 58 of the defense. This play is under review.
Ojo, the sophomore from Summit, California. Here's another look at it.
Now he's sliding, that means he's a defenseless player. Let's see if he led with his head. It looks like he got him with the forearm across the helmet. I don't see that was done with malicious intent. I think this is a judgment call by the officials, the replay officials, because I don't see malicious intent. He led with his forearm. He did not launch himself. He did not lead with his helmet, although he did make contact above the shoulders.
After further review, there is no targeting on the play.
Well, they can ill afford to lose Ojo, an athletic guy that's become a great football player, according to Coach Aaron Best. He'll stay out there.
And I tell you what was key on that play. Mayer had a lot of time to go down the field, but there was great coverage on the back end by Eastern Washington. So I thought it was a good decision for Mayer to tuck the ball and try and get positive yards as opposed to throwing it into traffic.
Early indications are they're going to be able to protect him, at least it looked like on that last pass attempt. He had plenty of time back there. Second and 10 from the 43. Changing it up at the line of scrimmage.
And you see the defensive linemen moving. They want to mess with the pre-snap reads of the quarterback.
Mayer, pistol formation, hands it off to Gilliam, trying to stretch it to the outside. Down he goes, a big loss near midfield. Ojo was there, got some help from Kedrick Johnson.
And the offensive guards have got to do a better job of picking up the linebackers. You cannot allow Ojo to come down the hill and find a seam to get through to get to the backfield. You've got to have good recognition, and that starts with knowing who you have to block. That's that pre-snap movement I talked about early with this defensive line moving around.
Third and 17. This will be a tough one to pick up. The Aggies very good on third downs, but they need to get to the 33-yard line to keep this drive going. Mayer steps up to the sideline, and it's going to be well short of the first down. That was Wes Priest, the tight end, Josh Lewis there, and the pressure and the run support good from the Eagles here on this first series.
And a good job by the Eastern Washington defense to bend but not break. They did a good job on the back end with their coverage. They did not give Jake Mayer anywhere to go at the football. And a good decision by Mayer, not trying to force it. The thing that you don't want to do if you're UC Davis is start the turnover game, something that they had an issue with in the last ball game.
Daniel Whelan, who has put 25 inside the 20 this year, gets an end-over-end kick away. Simba Webster calling for the fair catch, and he makes it at the 10-yard line. So the Eastern defense, after that 37-yard punt, does their job, now hands it over to a dynamic offense. School records this season in rushing yardage, rushing touchdowns, yards per carry, total offense. Only FCS school in the top 20 in total offense, rush and pass. And Eric Berrier, a big reason why, as he takes over here. Just a sophomore, great upside. 6-1 as a starter. Started a game last year. Taking over for Gubrud, he's been very good. They'll go to a little screen pass to the slot, and nothing doing. Simba Webster shut down by Aaron Duncan, who had a big game from his safety spot last week.
And Andrew Boston, the wide receiver, has to do a better job of blocking on the outside.
Duncan, a former walk-on, heart of a lion, according to his coach, drops him for a loss of 4. They send Webster in motion. Play action, Barrier rolling, dumps it off to Webster out of the slot, across the 15, and gets a lot of that yardage back just shy of the first down. Impact players.
Well, for Eastern Washington, left tackle Bo Bias moved over from tight end when the starting left tackle Tristan Taylor went down with a season-ending knee injury. And that is impressive because he's a dancing bear on the outside. When you lose your left tackle, you use your best line of offense, your best protector for your quarterback. So he's done a good job, and he's undersized at 265 pounds.
On 3rd and 1, they go to Sam McPherson, and he has a first down for Eastern Washington up to the 24-yard line. 4 100-yard games, a grinder, an overachiever. Atabafo Washington keeps his drive going.
And for UC Davis, Vincent White, he is their best cover guy. He can come down in the box, and he's not afraid to take on ball carriers. He leads the team with 18 pass breakups. He's second team all-conference.
Barrier to the air on first down, completes it to Terrence Grady on the far sideline, and there's White on cue with the tackle. Short gain up to the 28. Yards after catches are so key for both of these teams today.
Well, what both quarterbacks want to do is get the ball to their athletes in space and allow them to be playmakers and make plays. What'll be interesting is game-altering plays. Will we see those big plays?
This is an Eastern Washington team that leans on the run game a lot more than they have in years past. You think of Cooper Kupp, the All-American receiver, now with the Rams. They have excelled running it as well as throwing it this year. Here's Barrier to the sideline. Andrew Boston, the catch, gets a block, and he has a first down up to the 39-yard line. 10-yard pickup. And Montel Bland on the tackle.
And you see Barrier's athletic ability. He's able to escape the pocket, get to the outside, throw a strike. And what I love about this play is Jace Gilbert, number 89, the tight end, comes across to make a big block to allow Boston to get north and south and get up the field.
They love their tight ends, and they're all big guys that can clear space in the run and the pass game. Barrier, impressive numbers this year, running and throwing it. They'll run it here straight ahead with McPherson, hit by Bland and hit a second time as he moves the pile forward to the 42 for 3 yards. Mason Moy, their heart and soul, second team all Big Sky linebacker on the stop.
Well, what you'll see throughout the afternoon is multiple defenders hitting ball carriers. If you're the initial defender, if you can't get him down, you want to hold him up to allow your teammates to come and pull at the football, tug at the ball, and get hits.
On 2nd and 7, it's McPherson again. Tough sledding, but moves that pile a couple yards shy of the first down at the 47. They love to run it. And this is a team that says they'll run the ball for yards and throw it for miles. They want to lean on the run game first.
Well, you see the surge at the offensive line, and you see the guards getting up to the second level, getting a body on the linebackers, covering them up. That'll be key for this offense. Can those guards get up to the second level and cover up these linebackers?
Now they go empty set. They line up McPherson as a wide receiver top of the screen. They put Dotson in motion. It's a quarterback keeper for Barrier. Did he get there? It'll be close. He needed the 49. Called his own number, Jordan Franklin, the nose tackle on the stop.
And something that should not be understated, when you lose your quarterback, an All-American candidate, and you lose your left tackle, an All-Conference candidate, those are big, big losses. The left tackle is usually the most important lineman on the field because you're protecting the quarterback's backside. So when you lose both of those guys and still have the success that they've had in this offense, it tells you about their coaching staff and the caliber of players on this Eastern Washington ball club.
Coaches preach balance. How about that balance right there? Pass versus run. They've been as good as anybody. Here's Barrier with a seam, 30, and he's bumped out of bounds at the 20-yard line, showing off his speed right there. Isaiah Olave finally got to him.
and you see the vision of Berrier. He's almost like a running back in the backfield playing quarterback. He goes with the ball fake. Everyone flows to the ball carrier, and Berrier brings it back, and that's that RPO. That's a good decision by Berrier, reading what the defense was doing.
After the 33-yard pickup, they go to the air. The tight end, Henderson Belk, and he's cut down inside the 5-yard line. Devin King on the tackle, but they go to Belk, the senior, and they're knocking on the door.
Now, when you run the football effectively, you're able to sneak a tight end out of the backfield into the flat, and a good job by Berrier, allowing him to clear the defensive line before he delivered a strike to let him get up the field.
Belk, third team all Big Sky. Look at what they've done in the red zone this season. They've cashed in many times near the goal line and to the air. Berrier, touchdown, Terrence Grady. And the Eagles strike first.
When you run the football effectively, you get the defense on their heels. And that's what I saw on that touchdown play. You've got some defensive backs that look a little bit confused at the back end of this defense. Good job by the offensive line blocking. Easy pitch and catch for Berrier to Grady. Quick slant. Nobody's there to cover him up or make a play on the football.
Roldan Alcobendez, the sixth-year senior, one of the best kickers at the FCS level with a PAT. And he drills it 7-0. The run and the pass game effective for Coach Best. He had to like that drive. Berrier to Grady. His second touchdown catch of the year. Good start for the home team. A trip to the FCS semifinals on the line here. Eric Berrier 6-for-6 on that drive. 11 plays, 89 yards. Mixing run and pass, effective 6 passes, 5 runs. It's what they've done all year long.
Well, that's exactly what the doctor ordered for this Eastern Washington offense. And for UC Davis, they've got to regroup. They've got to understand it's still early in this ball game. But you have to understand as well that this is a balanced attack. You've got to play your role. You've got to stay in position. Don't look for the big play. Look to make the play that you're supposed to make.
Andre Slider. With the kick, Modise will get another chance to return it from his 3-yard line. Namani across the 20. They try to hem him in, and he finally goes down at the 24-yard line. The Eagles mixing run and pass effectively. Berrier did not make many mistakes, did he?
Well, he did a great job on this RPO. He read the defensive end crashing down, brought the ball back, and got up the field. And you see the speed to get to the outside. And on the next play, he's got the defense on their heels. He delivers a strike, a quick slant to the receiver, Grady, for the easy touchdown.
Fastest player on the team, according to the coaches, as you see the scoring drive. And he is a dual threat guy in every sense of the word, and hard to believe he's just a sophomore. Looks like a seasoned veteran, All-American type. Now the Aggies work to do. They'll start from the 24. They send Carson Crawford in motion and hand it off to Crawford. Trying to get to the outside. He's met right at the line of scrimmage. Cup was there. Got some help. But Cup has been active in the early going. Delonda Tucker helping him out on that play.
And right now the Eagle defense is flying up the field. You see guys coming across the line of scrimmage. They're coming downhill. I think for UC Davis, they've got to get vertical first before they can try and go east and west to get north and south.
Mayer on play action. Pocket collapsing, fires it late, and incomplete. Tried to drop it in the middle of the field with a bunch of red shirts around him, but pressure up the middle causing some problems for number 15.
Well, you see pressure in Mayer's face. He initially has time, but when a quarterback sees someone coming right in his face, when a quarterback sees the front of his offensive lineman's jerseys, he knows they're turning around to see where the defensive player is going that just beat them.
And that was a 300-pounder, Keith Moore, in his grill. Third and 10. Trips to the bottom of the screen here for Mayer. Blitz from Cup. Intercepted. It's picked off by Mitchell Johnson. And the Eagles have it back.
And pressure by Kettner Cup, number 40, did not allow Mayer to step into this throw. You see number 40 come through. A late attempt to try and block him. Cup is not able to step through on this throw. He throws it from his back foot. He didn't get enough on it. and that was an easy interception for Mitchell Johnson. And Mitchell Johnson has been a big surprise for this ball club all season. The coaching staff talked about him having the ability, but not knowing if it would be too big for him, and you see it hasn't been too big for him.
Three of Mayer's nine interceptions this year have come against the Eagles. Now we have a whistle here before the snap of the football.
The previous play is under review.
And you have to wonder, what are they reviewing on this play?
Mitchell Johnson with the clear-cut interception. What's the quarterback down?
That's what I was going to ask. What's the quarterback down? Let's see. No, he wasn't down.
Not even close.
Are they looking for a correct spot on the football?
Yeah, they've rectified this thing. They've cleared it. It's an interception, and we'll start first down again here. First down from the 20. Berrier calling his own number, and he is met by Terrell Cloud, the senior. Nose tackle drops him for a loss.
And on that play, you saw the offensive lineman pull around number 75. Their best offensive lineman is Spencer Blackburn. If you're going to pull, big fella, you got to find some work. You can't just go out there and get a no-hitter. You got to find you some work.
Cloud, known as one of those tackles that gets after the quarterback, and he had Berrier in his sights from the get-go. Second and 11 now. Handoff, McPherson straight ahead, nothing doing. Quincy Bennett was in there, the junior outside linebacker, and now you got a third and long.
And right now for UC Davis, you've got to have a bend but not break defense. Get a stop. Force a field goal attempt.
Key for the Eagles, as you look at the total yardage, win the one-on-one battles with their wide receivers, and they've got some big targets. Grady is 6'5". He's one of those, number 11. Four receiver look here. Pressure coming. Berrier stepping up, gonna run for it. Tripped up, and he'll be shy of the first down, out of bounds at the, just shy of the 11. About a yard shy of the first down.
And a good job by number 21, Devin King, to get to the outside. Not allowing Berrier to turn the corner. You see Berrier wants to turn the corner, but watch 21. You see him right there fight through the would-be blocker and force Berrier to keep going east and west. You cannot let him get north and south.
And they will not bring the kicking team out there. They'll go pistol formation. They'll go for it on fourth and one. McPherson trying to get to the edge. Will not get it done. Olave cuts him down, and the Eagles turn it over on downs.
And number 16, Aaron Duncan, on the outside, took on the blocker, allowing Olave to get around the edge and get up to the ball carrier. You talk about a big play in this ball game. I thought Eastern Washington should have went for the field goal as opposed to trying to get that first down.
Big stop for UC Davis in the red zone here at the Inferno. Still a 7-0 lead, but Eastern Washington turned away here on the red turf. Aaron Betts and the Eagles, a missed opportunity on that last series.
Well, I didn't think this was a good play call. When you're going downhill, you got a 40-pound differential in the offensive lineup for Eastern Washington versus the UC Davis defensive line. I think you go north and south, run the ball down the gut of the defense. Challenger, interior offensive lineman, the two guards in the center. If you guys can't get me 1 yard, we don't deserve to move forward. I think you run downhill, and if you're going to run the football, you can't get outside because now you're giving the defense time to flow to it. Me personally, I would have kicked a field goal.
Well, let's see if that shifts momentum here. UC Davis needed something positive to happen. They'll start this series from the 14. They set up the middle screen for Das, and he gets it up to the 18-yard line for 4 yards. Chris Ojo on the tackle. Yards after catch, so key. And they've obviously got a target on number 3. They'll live with that. A 4-yard pickup, a guy that has 26 career touchdown grabs. As you look at his season numbers, as good as anybody across America. Second and 6. In the flat, it's Gilliam. He has a first down across the 25-yard line to the 26. Kettner Cup on the tackle. Gilliam, a threat out of the backfield, 51st catch of the year.
Well, the coaching staff talked about Gilliam's ability to catch the football. They say he's got the best hands on the team. And this is what you want to do if you're UC Davis. Get the ball to your playmakers in space and allow them to make plays with their feet. You know that Eastern Washington is going to bring pressure up the field. So for Mayer, you've got to get rid of the football.
Three receivers left this time for Mayer. Handoff straight ahead. Gilliam again. He's up to the 34. This is a guy that's on the Rice watch list for the top FCS freshman. Gone over 100 yards a couple times this season.
And a good job by number 77, Ramsey Huffer, to come around and get a key block to open up a hole for Gilliam to get up the field. Those are key plays for this offense. Can you cover up these defensive linemen and give seams for these running backs to get up the field?
8-yard pickup. They sent Crawford in motion to the top of the screen. Mayer, pressure coming, steps up, fires the pass, caught. First down, Gilliam, and he spins to the 41-yard line. Coach Hawkins loves Yolonzo Gilliam, a man's man. He said he'd be a boxer if he's not a football player.
Well, once again, Mayer does a good job using his escapability. He gets pressure, he steps up in the pocket, delivers the ball to a playmaker, allows him to get up the field and get the first down. You don't have to get it all in one play. Just work your way up the field.
Look at Mayer's numbers so far. Had the one interception he'd like to have back. Little shuttle into the hands of the running back, and Teron Thomas can't get his footing. A flag comes in as he falls down, a loss back to the 38.
And once again, with the speed of this Eastern Washington defense, I think UC Davis is better off going downhill as opposed to east and west and trying to plant and then get downhill.
Like they're going to back him up here.
Holding, number 77 of the offense, 10-yard penalty, first down.
One of the issues when you're running a play to the outside for offensive linemen is a defensive lineman fighting across your face. And you see right here, the defensive lineman trying to fight across his face, and he grabs him. You've got to be able to take a power step up through the defensive lineman, get inside hands, and take them wherever they want to go. If they're beating you across the face, take them where they're going and allow your back to be dynamic and cut off of you.
Hufford, the left guard, senior from Newport Beach, California. First and 20 now, back at the 31. Pistol look this time for the Aggies. Gilliam, not much doing. Up to the 32. This is the Eastern Washington defense, much improved from years past when you look at what they've done versus the run. Second in the conference in the Big Sky.
Well, for UC Davis, you've got to run the football, even if you're not running effectively, because you want to keep the defense honest. You want to make them bring more players down in the box so you can get one-on-one matchups on the outside and try and get the football to your big play receivers, Doss and Harrell.
You see Doss, top of the screen there. He's in the slot with Crawford to his right. Mayer, all kinds of time, over the middle, Doss has it, and it's a first down grab to the Eagles 46. Climb the ladder with that 6'3 frame. Callen Kreiner on the tackle, pick up a 22.
Well, Mayer saw the matchup that he liked. He had a safety on Doss, and he allowed Doss to clear the defense and get in the middle of the field, and he put the ball up where Doss could high point the football, and the defender had no way to make a play on it.
We saw him put up big numbers, over 100 yards, catching the football in their win last week against Northern Iowa. They need a similar type game here to pull off a road victory and get to the FCS semifinals. Mayer to the sideline, catch made out of the backfield, it's Thomas. And he's bumped out of bounds at the 37. Josh Lewis on the tackle. This is a guy they call the Diesel. He goes 5'11 and 215.
Physical runner, and I love the way he catches the ball with his hands. You see Mayer? He sees where he wants to go with the football. Thomas gets possession of the football. Even though he was out of bounds, he did a smart thing by covering it up. You never know where you are, but a good job by Thomas to get the football, get possession of it, and get up the field.
They need the 36 to pick up the first down. Mayer, blitz coming, dumps it underneath. Catch made by Jared Harrell. He has a first down, a stiff arm on a defender, and he's out of bounds at the 30-yard line. First time we've called Harrell's name. He's a good one. His 60th catch of the year, third-team All-Big Sky. T. Oley on the tackle.
And one of the big things for UC Davis is yak. Yards after contact and yards after the catch. That's something that they do very well. You saw on that play, Harrell able to get yards after the catch to get the first down.
Impressive drive for the Aggies, trailing by a touchdown. Ninth play from the 30. Blitz again coming. Backside and the sack. Josh Lewis from his corner spot.
And Mayer's got to feel that. They came with the jet sweep action that did not fool the defense. They brought pressure by Josh Lewis on the outside. Mayer's got to be able to feel that. You see right here, right now, he should be feeling it. He should step up in the pocket. You cannot allow that to happen.
They really like Lewis headed to the NFLPA Bowl along with Tioli. And he dialed up the blitz the right time to end this first quarter. 7-0 Eagles. A rematch of a Big Sky game won by Eastern Washington a month ago, but a lot more at stake here. A trip to the FCS semifinals on the line. Eagles by 7, second quarter coming up. 7-point game as we start the second quarter here, FCS quarterfinal. 2 of 4 Big Sky teams to make it to the FCS playoffs. What a year it's been, and the co-champs, the Eagles, the Aggies, and the Wildcats. Weber State eliminated by Maine last night. It's been a banner season for the Big Sky. Rematch of a game won by the Eagles November 10th. After that blitz, a 2nd and 21 situation now for Jake Mayer and this UC Davis offense from the 41. Mayer with Ledbetter providing pressure, finds a man. It's caught by Doss, and he gets some of that yardage back. Cup on the tackle, but that moves him inside the 25-yard line. A flag comes in as well.
I think there was some extra trash talking on that play. And unfortunately for Eastern Washington, I think it's going to be on their defensive lineman, and it's going to give UC Davis a first down.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 72 of the offense, 15-yard penalty. That was 72's first unsportsmanlike foul.
Well, that's Riley Gallant, the right tackle, the guilty party.
And that's interesting because number 92 is coming off the field looking like he was upset for Eastern Washington. So, interesting call by the officials on that play. And right when UC Davis has a big play, you get something like that to happen to bring the ball back. And once again, it's an interesting call because you see Coach Best talking to his defensive lineman.
So the pass play to the 25, then they back him up the 15 for the unsportsmanlike conduct penalty, and the ball now at the 40.
And emotions are running high. I don't know if you should have made that call if you're the officials. It's a playoff game. They just had a big play.
Mayer underneath. It's a tight end, Wes Priest, and he's gang tackled at the 33-yard line. Cup was in the middle of things there. Now you got fourth down. You're outside of field goal range most likely for Max O'Rourke. Let's see what they have to do here.
And for the Eastern Washington defense, you want to keep everything in front of you. You don't want to allow them to get past the sticks. And once they catch the football, gang tackle the ball carrier. We talk about game-altering plays, and usually when you talk about game-altering plays, you talk about a big play by the offense or the defense. That penalty right there is a game-altering play because it stopped a drive that looked like UC Davis was in position to get a first down and move forward.
Daniel Whelan, the sophomore from Rancho Mirage, California, will try to pin him back here. End over end. It'll hit inside the 10, take a sideways hop, and roll all the way to the goal line. Did they get it down? They did, just inside the 1. Great punt from Whelan. Eagles have the ball back, leading by a touchdown.
Break the play at the goal line.
So the Eagles backed up. They'll go with 3 running backs next to Berrier and run it straight ahead. with their grinder, Sam McPherson, and he gives him some real estate up to the 7-yard line. This is a guy that isn't pretty, but was second in the FCS in average per carry, 7.6 this year entering today.
And what's dangerous when you have all your defenders in the boxes, if the back gets to the second or third level, there's no one there, and he's able to get up the field.
And it's McPherson again, an overachiever, which is kind of the Eastern mantra here, an Eastern kind of guy. They call it EKG, an overachiever, pushes the wall farther than you thought on and off the field, and this guy fits the bill.
And one of the things to look for UC Davis when the ball is on the opposite hash, can they get substitutions in the ball game? The coaching staff will watch the Eastern Washington coaches, and when they send substitutes in, they'll substitute players in as well.
Five receiver look here on first down. They'll run it with McPherson out of there, right up the gut with Dennis Merritt, the junior from Leavenworth, Washington, who's more of a lightning fast type of running back, land on the tackle.
Well, Eastern Washington with three wides to spread the defense out, and you see the huge gap for the running back Merritt to run through. There was no one there.
They've got four guys they can run. Look at the numbers so far. A dominance in the November 10th meeting. Different story here. UC Davis, but no points on the board. Berrier looking to throw it this time. Rolling away from Bland. Bland's got him, and he drops him back at the 10-yard line.
And a great play by number 57, Terrell Cloud, to flush Berrier outside of the pocket. Watch 57, he beats the defender, flushes Berrier outside of the pocket. Once he does that, the other defenders with pursuit get up the field, and you see Bland able to get Berrier down.
They love their linebackers because of their versatility, but the number one thing, they can really run. Bland, a redshirt freshman from Modesto. Now a run up the middle for Merritt, gets some of that yardage back and spins up to the 22-yard line, a third and long coming up. Aaron Duncan on the stop.
And right now for UC Davis, you want to keep all of the offensive players in front of you. You can't let anyone get behind you if you're a defender. You want to keep them in front of you. You want to get pressure on Berrier, make him get rid of the football.
So Anthony Baumgart, the senior defensive tackle, he's one of their pass rush specialists. They've got him lined up on the outside, on the edge here on this third and long. Berrier under duress. Down he goes at the six. Great pressure up the gut. That was Mason Moy. He got some help from Baumgart and others, and they'll force him to punt it and should get excellent field position.
And what UC Davis did on that play, they showed four defensive linemen, but they brought six. They brought the linebackers on a delayed blitz, which did not allow Berrier to get to the outside. Because you've got speed coming down the hill against Berrier, he's not able to use his footwork and get to the outside. Mason Moy, that big-time defensive player for UC Davis, makes a big, big play on third down.
On the Buck Buchanan watch list this year from Hawaii, and they'll punt it from their own end zone now. Alco Bendez, end over end. It'll hit at the 43. It's returnable, but nowhere to go for Modise as he's knocked down at the 48-yard line. Short field, though, for UC Davis when we come back after that 44-yard punt. 7-0, Eagles lead the Aggies. Two of the top FCS offenses, but defense has drawn the headlines here in the first half so far. Montel Bland and also Moy, effective rushing the quarterback.
Well, a good job by the defensive line to flush Berrier outside of the pocket, and a better job by the linebackers to get up the field and get Berrier down. If you don't, he's fleet of foot. If he gets to the outside, he's maybe able to get up the field. Mason Moy, the big play defender, comes up big on that third down.
Look at those numbers. Rushing the quarterback, also 17th in the FCS in turnover margin. Done a great job on that side of the ball. Short field now for Mayer to work with. Goes to the sideline. Gilliam the catch. Blocker in front. Still keeping his footing, and he has a first down. Great second effort down to the 37. Josh Lewis on the tackle.
And I love the job by number 87, Wesley Priest, on the outside. You see a key block right here. That key block does not allow the defenders to get up the field, and he keeps going. You'll get him, see him back in the screen, still blocking. A great job by the outside offensive players to get blocks.
From the pistol play action for Mayer, setting up the screen for Gilliam. Gets a block from the tackle, and he's tripped up at the 31-yard line. That was actually Ramsey Hufford, the guard over there, with the block. Tioli on the tackle.
And you see a lot of moving parts for this UC Davis defense. When you've got an aggressive, offense, when you've got an aggressive defense like Eastern Washington, you've got to make those guys move around. A good job by Mayer to fake to the right and go back to his left.
After a 6-yard pickup, Mayer to the air, near sideline, incomplete. And on the same page that time with Darius Livingston, the sophomore wide receiver, it's third and four.
And I think that was a good bad throw because number 27, Kedrick Johnson, had a read on that football. And if Mayer puts the ball where it should have been, Kedrick Johnson might still be running towards the end zone.
UC Davis has moved the football. No points to show for it so far. Pitch to Gilliam. And shy of the first down, inside the 30. Looks like about a yard shy. Now you got a decision to make, fourth and one. Lewis again on the stop.
I don't think it's a decision. I think you definitely go for it. Your offense is moving the football. You're deep in their territory. This is where you challenge your offensive linemen. You tell those guys, you want to move on. These are the type of plays that you have to make as an offensive lineman.
They need 2 yards. You can see what they've done this season. Very good in the Big Sky. Das lined up bottom of the screen. He's their go-to guy. Myers 10 for his last 11 since the interception. They're going to run it. They cross him up the middle. Gilliam, he finds the end zone. Touchdown, Aggies. 29 yards, and they cross him up with an excellent play call.
And that's what I'm talking about. When you've got an aggressive defense like Eastern Washington, you bring Doss across for the jet sweep action. Everybody's going to react because they know he's a big-time player, and a good job by the offensive lineman to get a hat on a hat and allow for the back Gilliam to get up the field. No one touched him. A great play call by the UC Davis coaching staff.
That is a dozen rushing touchdowns for the redshirt freshman. The extra point is good from O'Rourke, and we're all even. How about this play call?
Great play call, great misdirection, and a good job by Gilliam to get to the end zone.
Here. Join ESPN and the V Foundation to fight against cancer. Visit v.org/donate. All donations benefit the V Foundation for cancer research. Well, Coach Dan Hawkins back at his alma mater coaching, and he loves this redshirt freshman, Yolanzo Gilliam. Great receiver and runner, but also a double major in biochemistry and molecular biology. What a great school UC Davis is. They've got some very skilled youngsters. That was not my major, by the way. I don't know if you went that route. I went the journalism route. This will be returnable. It's McPherson across the 25 to the 28-yard line. So the momentum, that was actually Dennis Merritt on the return. The momentum now shifting after that touchdown. Merritt right up the gut with this return.
Well, you see Merritt able to get positive yards, and a good job by UC Davis to get him down, because if he's able to squeeze through, there are no other defenders. Now, for Eastern Washington, their offensive line, they have to do a better job of identifying where possible blitz packages can come from. You're going to continue to see UC Davis move around in their pre-snap sets to confuse the offensive linemen. You want to make those guys think. And for Barrier, he's been flushed outside of the pocket, but they've had guys coming up the field on the outside to not allow him to get north and south.
They'll run it straight ahead, and busting it up the gut is McPherson. A big gain and a first down up to the 40-yard line. 12-yard pickup, Mason Boy. I don't know if you went that route. I went the journalism route. This will be returnable. It's McPherson across the 25 to the 28-yard line. So the momentum, that was actually Dennis Merritt on the return. The momentum now shifting after that touchdown. Merritt right up the gut with this return.
Well, you see Merritt able to get positive yards, and a good job by UC Davis to get him down, because if he's able to squeeze through, there are no other defenders. Now, for Eastern Washington, their offensive line, they have to do a better job of identifying where possible blitz packages can come from. You're going to continue to see UC Davis move around in their pre-snap sets to confuse the offensive linemen. You want to make those guys think. And for Barrier, he's been flushed outside of the pocket, but they've had guys coming up the field on the outside to not allow him to get north and south.
They'll run it straight ahead, and busting it up the gut is McPherson. A big gain and a first down up to the 40-yard line. 12-yard pickup, Mason Boy on the tackle.
And this is the bread and butter for this Eastern Washington ball club. They want to pound you on the inside. You see the ability by McPherson to bounce off would-be tacklers.
They're going to throw it to the side to Webster, and nothing doing as UC Davis has really shut down the perimeter well. Moy was over there. Going side to side, sideline to sideline, has not been a good idea for the Eagles in this one.
I think for either ball club, because it's too much speed on both defenses, and they're coming up the field playing aggressively. They're playing man coverage on the outside. So I think when you play man, you've got linebackers that are flowing to the football.
On second 11, they'll try to run to the edge. It's McPherson, and he gets it to the 44, 5 yards on the pickup. Mason Moy on the tackle, third long coming up.
And a good job by Moy. He got a good hit on the initial contact. He held on to him and allowed his teammate to come over and finish him off. If you can't make the tackle, hold on to the offensive player to allow pursuit to get there.
You see the Berrier numbers. He was 6-for-6 on their opening touchdown drive, has been quiet since. But a guy that can bust the big play at any moment. They'll go empty set this time and five receivers. Berrier over the middle, short of the stick. That won't get it done. Gang tackled, short of the first down. Bland was in there to stop Simba Webster. It's fourth down.
And Berrier threw the ball prematurely. They only brought four pass rushers on that play. They dropped seven back into coverage. I thought Berrier had time to climb the pocket and find a receiver down the field. You can't go underneath if he's not going to be past the sticks. Berrier got rid of the ball prematurely, I thought, on that play. And that's because of previous pressure by this UC Davis defense.
Right, both defenses have stood tall here in the first half as Roldan Alcobendez stands back at his 34-yard line. Tries to kick it away from Modise, who lets it hit at the 25. Comes up on it now and makes the play at the 17. Dangerous play, but Modise hangs on. We have a player down here and a flag on the field to sort out. There's a flag at the 42-yard line. No injuries, the players are now off the field, but a flag they've got to sort out here.
Personal foul, face mask, 29 of the kicking team. That 15-yard penalty will be added to the end of the kick.
And it'll go against Anthony Smith. All even, nothing settled between the Big Sky co-coaches of the year. Done a tremendous job at UC Davis, philosophically home, back at his alma mater.
But one thing I like that Coach Hawk said is, can you be your best on every play? Can you invest in the process? And can you rally from adversity? And you see that early from his ball club in this ball game.
See where he has been. Stops along the way. Great success at Boise State in Boulder with the Buffs. And now back at his alma mater. Says getting some kids recruited by the Pac-12 and Mountain West schools. Well, Keelan Doss is one of those that has to be fun to coach. You see it. He has seen a lot of different stops. He's an Eddie Robinson Coach of the Year candidate still, Big Sky Co-Coach of the Year, drawn a lot of praise nationally as well. And his team really stepping up after losing 59-20 here. They turned the ball over five times in the first meeting, playing well here in the postseason. Here's Carson Crawford, the wide receiver, pass downfield, caught by Harrell inside the 30. A little gadgetry, and it works to the 23-yard line. Delondo Tucker on the tackle.
Well, there were a lot of moving parts on this play. First of all, it was a low snap. And for Mayer to be able to get down that low and gather the snap was excellent. And we see Harrell down. We hope it's nothing serious.
44-yard pickup. Crawford, a former high school quarterback, and that is the second pass he's completed this year. Looked very comfortable delivering that on target.
Well, if you saw what Crawford did, he bent it around a little bit to allow Harrell to break out into the open, and that is a good job. A lot of times you see receivers run straight to the sideline. They want to get rid of the football to make the big play as opposed to allowing the receiver to break open and get separation.
Here's a look at Crawford, who has been a slot receiver, a holder, and we see a quarterback as well. And let's hope that Jared Harrell is okay after that big pass reception. All even, 44 yards. Harrell shaken up at the end of this play.
Let's see how he comes down. And you see his leg got bent up under him and the defender fell on his leg. Let's just hope it's not too serious and he'll be able to come back into the ball game. He did not look to be able to put pressure on it as he was helped off of the field. So you just have to hope that he's able to get back into this ball game and the injury is not as serious as it looked.
That's a third team All Big Sky performer. Their number two target behind Keelan Doss. Be a tough loss for Coach Hawkins with 6:37 to go here in the second quarter. You see the numbers. You see Davis has flipped the script here in the second quarter, and they have momentum, a chance to take the lead now, nearing the Eastern Washington red zone. Go with Christian Skepteris as a second tight end. He split to the left side, just off the line of scrimmage. Priest, the tight end to the right side in this formation. Handoff, Gilliam up the gut. Gilliam has a first down. He's inside the 10, and Gilliam has a touchdown. His second of the game, and the UC Davis run game delivering big dividends here in the first half.
Well, the offensive linemen take huge splits. So when you've got those type of splits, Gilliam's going to find huge lanes if the defenders aren't able to fight across their face. And you see him power himself into the end zone, fighting off Zuzi Webster, who tried to make the tackle.
They're showing they can play a physical brand of football, not just a team that can beat you with the finesse game, the pass game. It's a team third in the nation in passing offense, not known for the run game, but they're getting it done with Gilliam.
Well, on both touchdowns by Gilliam, he's had huge holes to run through, and you see him looking for Webster, and he gets that stiff arm out and powers his way into the end zone. A great job by the offensive line to get up in those guys, and you see all the white jerseys, a hat on a hat. They've covered up every defender. You've got a defender coming across the field to try and make a tackle on an offensive player that's got momentum going forward.
Two plays, 68 yards. You see Gilliam's numbers. He has 105 yards of all-purpose offense as well. And they have relied on those guys up front. They might not be as big as Eastern Washington, but they're winning the line of scrimmage right now.
Well, what they've done is when they get those wide splits, it allows for them to get up. It's almost like a zone blocking scheme because you have so much space when you've got backs that are dynamic like Gilliam, like Thomas, like Mo Dice. They're able to use their dynamic ability and get up the field. You don't have to knock a guy out to make a great block when you've got dynamic backs. You just need to get in the way and give those guys a lane to run through.
Matt Blair, their kickoff specialist, to kick it away. Merritt, the deep man for Eastern Washington. Last two drives, they've only burned 2 minutes off the clock, but they've been effective running it as a flag comes in and Merritt goes down right at the 20-yard line.
And I go back, Trey, to not getting the field goal when they were deep in UC Davis territory to take a 10-0 lead.
Coach Best had to love the start. 11 plays, 89 yards to take the lead 7-0. It's been all UC Davis since.
During the return, blocking the back, number 14 of the receiving team. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
It's on a Darian Sampson of the Eagles, a freshman from South Seattle.
Well, on that fourth down stop, I think you gave life to the UC Davis football team because they were on their heels defensively. They weren't doing a good job of slowing down this Eastern Washington offense. And defensively, Eastern Washington, you know, just have not made the plays that they made early in the ball game.
They'll start deep again. And to start one drive inside their one-yard line, this one will start just outside the eight. Verrier hands it off. Up the gut. They've found good yardage there between the tackles, and it's McPherson for a first down up to the 21. Land on the stop.
You see the defensive lineman make a shift prior to the snap, but a good job by the offensive lineman flushing everything down. And I like what I see from the offensive lineman in the middle of this offensive line, in the gut of it.
McPherson straight ahead. Not much doing this time. A couple yards as Bland bottles things up. Now, you also have to look at what Eastern Washington is doing here if you're an Eagles fan and not be too concerned. They've been a great second half team. They trailed Nichols early and then routed them 42-21 in their last game.
And something to watch for as well. Mason Moy is playing kind of a spy position on the outside, keeping an eye on Berrier.
McPherson gets to the edge, and he has a first down. And he's run out of bounds at the 35. They want a late flag, and they're going to get it. After McPherson ran out of bounds, an extra shove, and they're going to tack on some yardage here.
And I agree, it was a penalty, but you see McPherson right here able to bounce it to the outside. A good job. He's able to get up the field. And I don't know about that play. It wasn't as big as it looked in. But you see the Eastern Washington coaching staff lobby for that penalty, and the official obliged and threw the flag.
That was Hunter O'Brien, a senior, the guilty party, it appears.
After the play, personal foul, late hit out of bounds, 86 of the defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
I understand you've got to protect the football players, but this is football. And he did not give a super aggressive push on that play.
That'll move it to the Aggie side of the field for Coach Best and company, trying to get things jump-started after a good first drive. They've been stagnant since. Berrier goes to the air. It's his tight end. Henderson Belk turns it upfield, and he has a first down inside the 36. Duncan finally slings him down. That's a big body at 6'4", 245.
And a great play by Eastern Washington. They come with the counteraction to the left of the defense, allowing for Berrier to go back to the other side. And a good job by Belk to get possession of the football and power himself up for the first down.
They have Pierce, a running back, lined up in a slot. Berrier over the middle, has a man. It's a first down again, and it's Belk. Down to the 14.
And Berrier with the pump fake and delivers the ball, a strike down the seam to the tight end. They've got something going with this tight end play. The tight end takes a hop step off the line of scrimmage, influencing the linebackers to step up, thinking he's coming to block him. And then he shoots up the field, and a good job by Berrier to deliver a strike.
22-yard pickup, and they've picked up the tempo here a little bit as well. As they get closer to the goal line, three receivers left. Belk lined up on the line of scrimmage this time. Handoff. Nope, fake the handoff. It's Belk, the tight end again. And he finds the end zone.
And UC Davis decided not to cover Belk on that entire drive. Is he the secret weapon? You gotta cover him up. But you see, Belk comes off the line of scrimmage like he's getting ready to block Anthony Baumgart, allows him to release to the outside. You've got to play your position, not look for the big play. And you see on that play, Baumgart gave up the big play, allowing Belk to release to the outside, and no one covered him.
Alco Bendez ties it up with the extra point. We talked to Bodie Reeder, the offensive coordinator. He says, we love our tight ends. We like to feed them the ball whenever we can, and that was Belk's drive.
Watch on the outside. Belk goes with the initial block like he's going to block, and then he almost dropped the ball. He was so excited because no one was there to cover him up. I think Baumgart has to make sure he stays with the tight end. You can't squeeze down and look at the ball carrying, the ball faking, go down inside because you left Belk wide open.
Third team all Big Sky, the senior, evens things up here. An important drive for Coach Best and company to get that momentum back. And they have had a couple long drives to get their two scores. That could bode well as the game wears on.
Well, for UC Davis, there were some lapses on defense on that drive. They've got to just do a better job of recognition, staying with the tight ends. And once again, you can't look at the football. You've got to look at what your responsibility is as a defender and make sure you're covering the guy that you're supposed to be covering. Now, what's big for Eastern Washington, if they can get a stop, they get the ball coming back out in the second half. So for UC Davis, I think it's important to try and drive the ball down the field and try and get some more points on the board going into halftime.
Six play, 91-yard drive. Belk caps it off with a touchdown grab. A trip to the FCS semifinals. A date with Maine upcoming to the winner. And the winner of this one will host that game. Here's Martinez on the return for the Aggies. Nice return to the 30. And gives him good field position at the 32-yard line. ESPN's coverage of the FCS Championship continue next weekend with semifinal coverage on ESPN2. For more information, go to NCAA.com, the official online home for all 90 NCAA championships. 89-yard drive and a 91-yard touchdown drive. The two scores for the Eagles.
Well, you just ought to call this the Belk drive. You see him get the ball to the outside and just power through defenders going backwards to get the first down. And here, right down the seam, squeezes the football. And then he sneaks to the outside. Baumgart lets him go, and he gets to the end zone. But he almost dropped it. He was so excited because he was wide open.
Here's Mayer setting up the screen to Gilliam. Hit hard at the line of scrimmage and dropped. That was quite a hit. Forstall finally finishing off the ball carrier, but DeJonte Hayes is down. He put the initial hit on him, and He's shaken up at the 28-yard line.
And with Harrell not being in the ball game, how does that affect this offense for UC Davis? I see Harrell over on the sideline now running, trying to see if he can put pressure on that foot. He looks pretty good right now. He may be able to get back into the ball game. But defensively for Eastern Washington now, that's one less weapon that they have to worry about guarding. Does that allow them to bring more pressure and not allow Mayer to get comfortable and be comfortable back there trying to pass the ball down the field?
Aza Jr. from Tacoma, their starting safety. They've been riddled with injuries. Mitch Fettig, their veteran safety, third-team All-Big Sky, not on the field. And now Hayes shaken up. We talked about how a trip to the FCS semifinals is on the line. One semifinal is set, and it'll be a rematch of the Missouri Valley Football Conference powers, North Dakota State and South Dakota State.
A battle of the Dakotas. That should be a great, great ball game next weekend.
The Bison have been sensational. Winners of six of the last seven FCS championships. Aggies with the advantage in total yardage. Under 4 minutes to go here, first half. Mayer, all kinds of time. Deep ball, he wants Doss. Into double coverage, it picked off. Anthony Smith, the freshman.
Bad decision by Mayer. There were three defenders back there. They had Doss bracketed. You've got a safety playing deep. You've got a cornerback underneath. And you've got a linebacker dropping back. That is a bad play by Mayer. You can't get it all. You've got time. You don't have to try and get it off, but you see all the defenders dropping back. There are three defenders back there with one wide receiver, and then he throws it where the wide receiver has to try and get across the field to make a play. If you throw it where Doss is, he has the athletic ability to get up and make a play for you, but you threw it to the opposite side. A bad play, and once again, when you don't have Harrell in the ball game, the defenders are more comfortable triple covering Doss.
Smith's first pick of the year, a big one. Here's Berrier now. With time to work with, he'll just run out of bounds here, nothing doing, and he'll take the loss back to the 21-yard line. It also gives them 3:32, three timeouts, and a chance to grab the lead here before halftime.
And they get the ball coming back out in the second half, which I think is very important as well. So if you're UC Davis, you've got to get a stop. You cannot allow them to score on this drive.
How about the sophomore Berrier facing an active UC Davis defense? Couple long touchdown drives. He'll go with three receivers to the left side of the formation here. Quarterback keeper. And did not fool the Aggies. Gets back close to the original line of scrimmage. Third down and long coming up. Jordan Franklin was in there, the junior nose tackle.
And what I like about this play, watch number 34, Mason Moore. He is playing a spot position. See him on the right side of your screen. He does not want to allow Berrier to get to the outside. That is what you have to do when you face a dynamic quarterback that can run the football effectively. You've got to have a spy at times, mix it up. You don't want to allow him to get to the outside.
Berrier, far sideline, and incomplete. Boston had it for a moment, and then knocking it free was Vincent White. A great play. He stayed with it all the way through.
And that's why Vincent White is the best cover corner on this ball club. You see him turn around and locate the football. Berrier went through his progressions. You see White turn around, locate the football, and keep fighting all the way down, because the offensive player had possession, but he fought him all the way down and did not allow Boston to squeeze the football. Too often we see defensive backs go through the offensive player. They don't turn around and locate the football. Great job by White. Man, that's 19 pass breakups so far this season.
Yeah, number one in the Big Sky in that category. Here's the punt now from Alco Bendez. Modise a chance at a return. He's to the 40. Modise, excellent, right up the hash, and gives the Aggies excellent field position at the 47. 48-yard punt, but a return close to midfield, and now you see Davis. A lot of time and the three timeouts to work with. It's been a well-played game. We've seen some good defense, some long drives, and you can see why you're looking at two of the top teams in the FCS right here.
Well, I think it's going to come down to discipline. Which defense is disciplined enough to do their job and not try and make those big, big plays? Big plays will happen, but don't try and make them. Do your job.
One interception for Mayer. The key was don't turn it over after coughing it up five times in the last meeting. They go to the ground game. Gilliam right up the gut, and he's to the eastern side of the field. The ground game has been very good, and that sets up the pass that much better for UC Davis.
Well, with the huge splits that the UC Davis offensive line take, it allows for lanes for these running backs to run through.
And here's Gilliam again. And he has a first down, and he has more to the outside, and he's run out of bounds inside the 30. Callan Kreiner finally got to him. Huge first half for the redshirt freshman.
And a big play by number 60, the true freshman, Jake Parks. Watch him clear out on this pull. Watch 60 right here. Boom! That's what you have to do. And you see Gilliam able to get to the outside. He's such a balanced runner. He's got great vision and good balance. And when he gets to the outside, he's able to beat the defender.
See two of the top scoring teams in the country. Defense has stepped up here in the first half so far. Mayer in some trouble this time. Rolling. Now he's going to tuck it. And he runs out of bounds back near the original line of scrimmage.
And Mayer's not as fleet of foot as Barrier, but you see him with his escapability, and he did the smart thing. Get out of bounds. Don't use a timeout. You still preserve your three timeouts. You don't want to make a bad pass and try and force something.
Both teams over 40 points. Top 10 numbers offensively. UC Davis trying to get another score on the board here and take the lead before halftime. Mayer, a Peyton Award candidate. Gonna run it this time with Thomas. And he gets three, and that's it to the 28. They still need the 19-yard line, the line to make. So third and nine coming up. Kedrick Johnson on that last stop.
And for the UC Davis fan base that's wondering why they're not taking the timeout, it's third down and long. You don't want to take a timeout if you don't get this third down converted to a first down and give Eastern Washington more time.
They bring Lance Babb in as a receiver, the true freshman lined up in a trips formation, top of the screen. Gilliam now has 96 yards on the ground. This is a passing down here.
And remember in the last ball game, these are some of the plays where they caught Eastern Washington. They ran the football on obvious passing downs.
Mayer zips it for a first down. It's a grab by Doss, and they've got a first down at the 11-yard line. Pretty good option. You go to the top receiver, arguably, in the country.
And what Doss continues to do a good job of is finding a soft spot in the zone and making himself for his quarterback big.
17-yard pickup. Now back to the ground game. It's Thomas. The Diesels hit once and twice and driven backwards after a couple yards. Kentner Cup put a big pop on him.
Ron Thomas, the ball carrier.
And number 29, Anthony Smith, needs to adjust his chin strap because he took the brunt of that hit to Ron Thomas on that play.
Aggies are going to use their first timeout here, two remaining, with 41 seconds to go before halftime. Last week against Nichols, it didn't look good early, down 14-3 at halftime, but good things started with this blocked field goal.
Dylan Ledbetter's able to get his big paw up there and knock that ball down. He's had three blocked field goals this season. A great job to get that block, and you see the return for the touchdown by Keegan Johnson. That changed that whole ball game, one of those game-altering, game-changing plays.
39 unanswered points, and they win it going away 42-21 against a really good Nichols team that you and I have both seen, a team that beat Kansas this year, a team that really gave them trouble in the first half, but they've been a good second-half team all season long.
Well, they created turnovers in the second half of that ball game, four turnovers by that Nichols ball club. That was the difference in that ball game. When you look at the last time these two teams faced, five turnovers when UC Davis had a 10-point lead.
Second and eight, just inside the 10 now. Empty backfield here. They're going to go Wildcat. Thomas is going to take the direct snap to the short side of the field. Turns it up. Thomas hit and dropped. Let's see where they mark this. He is down after taking a big hit from Kentner Cup, who's really been laying the wood today from his linebacker spot.
Yeah, the defense confused, trying to find out what was going on. And you see Thomas get to the outside. Good job by the offensive lineman to get to the defender, and Thomas takes a hit. He did not see Cup coming from the side, so he was exposed. His midsection and rib area was exposed, and Cup got a shoulder pad right in that area. So hopefully it's just the wind knocked out of Thomas and he'll be able to get back in the ballgame.
Cup second team All Big Sky defensive co-captain. His brother Cooper, one of the all-time greats ever at the FCS level, now a wide receiver for the Rams, a four-year All-American. And Kettner has really made a name for himself. Their leading tackler, interception return for touchdown. He had a career-high 12 tackles against Nichols in their last game. Here's a look at Cooper's banner. Look at all those accolades for his brother.
And Cup just has that square chin look about him, that old school, I love to play football look about him. He's going to come downhill. He's going to bring that slobber knocker type of football. And you love what you see with him running around, making plays all over the field.
He had a dad, Craig, that played in the NFL, a grandpa that played in the NFL. He's got a brother playing in the NFL. That's a football family right there.
Football DNA 101.
You know, and Thomas, a big guy, shaken up. It's not easy to knock down the diesel, and he took quite a pop there. They'll have it inside the five-yard line, looking at a third and one here.
Well, he got hit from the side, and I don't think he expected Cup to come and hit him because he was going towards the out-of-bounds. And you know he's trying to get to the end zone, but he's also realizing, I've got to get out of bounds and stop the clock and give us more time and preserve those timeouts.
One timeout remaining. And on a third and one, a lot of ways you could go here. One of the options would be use your big target, Keelan Doss, in a situation in the end zone. A jump ball type situation for number three, maybe. But the run game's been pretty good.
Well, if I'm UC Davis, I think I'm going to try and run it in between the tackles. You've got a timeout left. So I think you try and run it in between the tackles, and if you don't get the touchdown, you use that timeout, and you go for a field goal. You want to have the lead going into the half. The last thing you want to do is come out of here with no points.
You know, and one of the keys for us in this first half has been field position. We've seen Eastern backed up inside their 10 a couple times. For UC Davis, their last four drives, the average starting field position, the 40-yard line. So the short field has benefited them. Big Sky co-champs here as it's a rematch with a trip to the FCS semifinals on the line. And they continue to look at Teron Thomas.
And an interesting side note is both coaching staffs talked about the offenses in this ball game and it possibly coming down to the offense that has the ball last. Because they felt like defensively, both defenses had to step up because of both offenses being very high powered. And you see the defenses have stepped up because it's not as much scoring as we thought we'd see in this ball game. The defenses have done a good job so far of keeping pressure on the offense, keeping the quarterbacks unsteady, making them think with their pre-snap reads.
Two top 10 FCS offenses here and some concern now for Teron Thomas, sophomore from Goodyear, Arizona, a Phoenix suburb. Their second leading ball carrier behind Alonzo Gilliam this year. And Coach Hawkins talks so highly of these kids, true student athletes, a tremendous school there at UC Davis, one of the tops in the country. And he really kind of glows when he talks about coming back to his alma mater. And right now his number one concern is his running back. They gave UC Davis a timeout back here. This is an injury timeout, so they have two remaining.
Davis elected not to take a timeout to avoid the 10-second
run. And they're letting us know that here, that they have that second timeout.
Thank you.
What's been the biggest surprise here in the first half?
Well, it should be noted that because Davis did not take that timeout, there's a 10-second runoff on the clock, so it goes from 35 to 25 seconds. But I think the biggest surprise has been after those first two drives, UC Davis's defense has kind of figured it out a little bit. Mason Moy has played a spy position to, you know, keep Barrier contained. And I think they've done a good job of not allowing Barrier to beat them with his quickness and his footwork and allow him to get outside the pocket. He did that early. He had that big run that led to the first touchdown. But since then, they've kind of held their own against Barrier and not allowed him to be as effective.
Well, there's a good sign. Teron Thomas up on his feet here. Let's hope for the best for the sophomore, who is honorable mention All Big Sky this year.
And it is now third down.
So third and one.
And that's two key offensive players out for UC Davis, and Thomas and Harrell.
Gilliam, the running back. Doss is in a slot to the right on third and one. He's in motion now. Handoff, Gilliam spins. And I don't think he got there. He needed the two. He'll be shy of the first down. Callen Kreiner on the stop.
And you got the surge from the defensive line for Eastern Washington. You see all the red jerseys in the backfield for Eastern Washington. They felt they knew what was going to come with that play, a run down the middle of the defense. I like the idea by UC Davis, try and pound it in for the score.
And they take their second time out here with 4 seconds to go. Now you've got a fourth down. And they're going to bring O'Rourke out here. You got to take the points, get the lead here before halftime.
You definitely have to take the points, especially knowing that Eastern Washington is going to come back out and get the ball to start the second half.
Eastern opting to go for it on a fourth and one in the first quarter on their second drive and ended up coming up short. And Coach Best would like to have those 3 points back right now.
And I think what's more significant about those points that he did not take is those are points off of turnovers. That's why you want to get those points.
Now look at this. How about this formation here? We do not see O'Rourke coming out there, and now Eastern Washington will use a timeout. They originally had number 43 on the field, then they change it up, and they send Mayer out there with Doss and Modise in the backfield.
And to me, that's gamesmanship by Coach Hawk.
Trying to cross him up there, seeing what Eastern would show, and now Coach Hawkins may just go back to bringing the place kicker out there.
And you see Coach Hawk talking to the official. He may be talking about a player eligible to test the football. You know, you just never know what's going to happen with Coach Hawk.
Yeah, they showed that against Northern Iowa last week, a play similar to that, just to keep you honest. Keep you on your toes as a coach on that opposing sideline. And I don't see O'Rourke. How about this? No place kicker. Fourth down in this tie game. And Doss is the Wildcat quarterback. Now they shift it up. Mayer. Empty backfield at QB. And there's another timeout burned by Eastern Washington.
Eastern Washington, second timeout, 32nd timeout.
A little chess match going on now.
Gamesmanship once again.
Does he do it again?
Absolutely.
Make him burn that final timeout?
Well, what they're doing is they're looking to see what Eastern Washington, what type of defense they're going to play. And I think this plays into what Coach Hawk wants to get accomplished. You know, they come out with that formation. Eastern Washington is surprised. Eastern Washington comes out with their defensive formation to counter that. And then UC Davis shifts into the formation that they're actually going to be in. So now for Eastern Washington, you have to wonder, are they going to run through it with that formation? Are they going to shift back to the other formation? You just don't know at this point.
Well, they're showing it again. That Wildcat look with Doss in the middle. The quarterback, Mayer, actually has Doss who's left this time, and now they shift out of it. Now it's pistol with Gilliam behind the QB.
And you got Doss with single coverage on the outside at the top of the screen.
They snap it. Gilliam end around. It's Livingston. He's going to throw it. Intercepted. Tried to throw it back to the quarterback, and he's picked off. Picked off by Ojo. And that backfires, and we go into halftime in a tie game.
Take the points, both coaching staffs. You gotta take the points.
A crazy finish to this half. Here it is.
And right here, I thought you had Doss with single coverage on the outside up top. Go to Doss. Go to your big play guy. If he puts a little bit of air under the football initially when he got the football, Mayer was open. He just didn't go to him early enough.
Livingston, the southpaw, trying to cross him up, throwing it to the QB to no avail. And we've reached halftime in a very entertaining FCS quarterfinal here in Cheney.
And I still think both coaching staffs will go into the locker room and kind of question their decision-making. You've got to take those points. I think for UC Davis, it was more important to take those points and have a lead going into the half as opposed to Eastern Washington not taking those points early in the ball game. Now, I do think that helps because it's points off of turnovers, but they did not take them.
Coach Best joining us. That crazy finish there, Coach. How did you feel you responded after trailing there 14-7?
Well, you know, we're down 10-0 in the first encounter with this great ball club, and that's what two great teams do. They go back and forth, and we held serve. At the end, they held serve on us in the 4th-1 early when we went for it up 7-0. It's the way it goes, but hell of a play by Chris Ojo.
Coach, Mason Moore has been playing kind of a spy technique on Barrier, not allowing him to get outside, which is something he did early with success in the first quarter. How do you get him back going rushing the football?
Well, Eric Barrier may not be our option. You know, we may just stay with the tailbacks. Our other run game's been good thus far. We just kind of continue to lean and lean some more, and then just see where this thing takes us the next 30 minutes.
Coach, thanks for your time.
Appreciate it. Thanks, gentlemen.
Halftime tied at 14. A lot at stake here. A trip to the FCS semifinals and a date with the Maine Black Bears. UC Davis, Gilliam, a couple touchdown runs. But the Eagles answer, and they get a big stop at the end of the half. We're all even at 14.
I thought that, you know, you should have run the football once again. They had three opportunities to change the play, but Coach Hawk decided this is what he wanted to go with. And you see right there, Mayer was open initially on that play, but they allowed the defender to get underneath and get the pick.
You look at the numbers, UC Davis moved the football better in the second quarter, but three turnovers have proved costly for them.
Well, if you're Coach Hawkins, you've got to feel good going into the halftime. If you've got three turnovers and they have zero, they've got to shore that up. That's something they came into this ball game knowing that they did not do a good job of last time these two teams played with five turnovers. But they've got to shore that up, and it's going to be interesting to see which defense holds.
The winner will host the Maine Black Bears, already making it to the FCS semifinals with a win over Weber State. Big Sky matchup here, and all even at halftime in the FCS quarterfinals. Second half coming up from Cheney. A beautiful but cold, chilly day in Cheney, Washington. More coming, second half after this. Quarterfinal of the NCAA FCS Championship at the Inferno in Cheney, Washington. Getting ready for the second half as the UC Davis Aggies take on the Eastern Washington Eagles. And this one is not disappointed. Some long scoring drives, excellent defense, and missed opportunities for two teams that know each other well. Well, Eastern Washington, a tremendous football tradition. You go back to 2010, where they won the whole thing, and it was quite a season. A first-round bye, and then rolling over Southeast Missouri State. Took overtime to beat the Bison. Beat Villanova to set up a championship date with the Blue Hens of Delaware. Let's flashback. January 7th, 2011 in Frisco, Texas. Delaware dominating the first half, with the Eagles rallying in the third. Bo Levi Mitchell, three touchdowns in 20 minutes, 302 yards through the air, 20-19. Bo Baldwin, the head coach, now offensive coordinator at Cal, getting them that national championship. Maybe this is the magical year. Of course, a lot of people think North Dakota State the favorite, but a lot of work to do for Eastern Washington up against a really good UC Davis team, and great tradition here. They've had three Peyton Award winners, Bo Levi Mitchell, one of those.
Well, I think Coach Hawkins and his UC Davis ball club are going to have something to say about that in this second half. It's going to be interesting to see which defense can come up with more plays, more stops. I think that will be the determining factor. This has not been the offensive output that we expected in this ball game. It's been a defensive showdown.
UC Davis' first ever FCS playoffs. It's the 13th trip to the FCS playoffs for the Eagles. As you look at Dennis Merritt, Eagles will get the football first as we open up this third quarter. Matt Blair to kick it away. And Merritt from his goal line will return this one. And he's cut down short of the 20-yard line. Good coverage that time from the Aggies as Tiger Garcia got down there to knock him down. Last meeting, five turnovers were costly, and it really got away from the Aggies in the second half.
And that's what they have to avoid. You had three turnovers early in this ball, in the first half of this ball game. You cannot have turnovers in the second half. You expect to come out of here with a win.
The Eagles scored 21 straight to take the lead for good in the first half and then ran away from them. Here's Berrier on first down, and he's intercepted. Tries to go over the middle, and it is picked off by Isaiah Olave. What a start for the Aggies defense, and Berrier didn't look like he knew where he wanted to go with that football.
Well, Berrier tried to get the ball to Simba Webster right in the middle, but Olave just reads his eyes. See Olave right there, number five, sitting down right there, reading the quarterback's eyes. Berrier predetermined where he was going with the football. A poor throw, a low throw, where Webster could not even make a play on it.
Webster wasn't even close to the ball, and Olave, his second pick of the year, third-team All-Big Sky corner, sets up the Aggies in excellent position at the 28-yard line. First points turnover.
Points off of turnovers. Those are the things that win football games. Eastern Washington did not take advantage of that in the first half. Let's see if UC Davis can take advantage and get points off of a turnover.
Yeah, we talked about those three Aggies turnovers, and now a timeout before the snap of the ball here. We have a review of this interception.
The ball hit the ground, but as long as the ball does not move, it can hit the ground. That's going to be key. When the replay officials look at this football, did it move when it hit the ground? And I don't think you have anything definitive from the angles that we're seeing right now to suggest that the ball moved. The ball can hit the ground. Here's a good angle right here. I don't think the ball moved. There's nothing definitive to say that the ball moved. I think this is going to be an interception.
Again, the question, do you have enough to overturn the initial call on the field there?
And they're making sure he maintained possession when he rolled over.
Boy, this is a big call here. First play of the third quarter and a tie game with a trip to the FCS semifinals on the line. It would be the first turnover for Eastern Washington. The Aggies have given up three times. Here's the call from Bob Johnson.
After further review, the ruling of an interception stands.
So there it is. You had it right, partner. An interception for Olave.
Well, the ball touches the ground, but it never moved. And that's what they're looking for. First of all, they want to see if the ball moves when it touches the ground. And then they want to see if the defender is maintaining control of the football as he rolls over.
So first down, UC Davis at the Eagles 28. Gilliam has had a big half in the backfield with Mayer. Gets the handoff. Gilliam running right up the gut between the tackles and down to the 22. What a game. He's over the century mark. Kedrick Johnson on the tackle.
And once again, Jake Mayer is able to pick the football off the ground after a poor snap, and Gilliam is able to get up in those gaps and get positive yards.
Redshirt freshman making his presence felt in the postseason. They set up the screen this time. It's Doss with the catch. Doss hit at the 20 by Cup. And cut down there.
And watch how Doss uses his length on this play. He stopped at the 20 right there, but he falls forward. That's what you want your backs and receivers to do. Fall forward.
Still a yard shy, third and one now. Gilliam, first down and more. Inside the 15. It looks like they can get that on every play between the tackles. Johnson on the stop, the outside linebacker.
Well, what UC Davis is doing is they're bringing that jet action sweep motion across, so the defense has to react to that. And because of Gilliam's ability to get down the hill so fast, he presses the line of scrimmage. He's able to get positive yards before they can react to him having the football.
12 carries, 108 yards, couple touchdowns for Ulonzo Gilliam. He's been the MVP of this UC Davis offense so far. In the red zone now from the 13. They send Crawford in motion. Mayer over the middle. Goes underneath for a short gain. Catch made by Darius Livingston. He picks up 3 to the 10. Cup on the tackle.
And Mayer's doing a good job of reading the defense, taking what the defense gives him, not trying to get too much. You have to be careful with the football. There's not a lot of feel for the defense to have coverage, so they can put a lot more guys closer to the line of scrimmage.
They give him forward progress to the 9, a 4-yard pickup, 2nd and 6 now. Just underway third quarter. Mayer pitches it to Gilliam. Short side of the field on the run, nothing doing. He may have lost yardage. They knock him down right at the 9. Dylan Ledbetter on the stop. Third down. Big call coming up here.
And the defensive line does a good job of getting up the field, not allowing Gilliam to get going north and south. If you get single coverage on the outside with Keelan Doss, I go for a fade route. Try and get the ball up to my big play receiver. Let him try and high point the football.
You can see Doss, number 3, bottom of the screen. They've got Lance Babb, a freshman, to the other side of the field. Now they move Doss into the slot. Some movement. Mayer to the end zone. Back shoulder throw. Babb has it for the touchdown. The true freshman. They're taking advantage of the red shirt rule. He's getting action late in the year, and he makes a big grab with Tucker covering to give him the lead.
Big play and big throw to the outside. Delondo Tucker had great coverage. You couldn't ask for anything else from Tucker on that play. Just a better play by the offense.
How about Babb, whose dad Lance was a USC track and field star and Olympian. He's from Montebello, California, near Los Angeles. Comes in, makes his first catch as an Aggie, and it's in postseason play here for the score.
The ruling of a touchdown is under review.
Okay, now Force, what are they looking at here?
Well, they want to make sure his feet are in, first of all, and then they want to make sure he's able to squeeze the football all the way through the catch, because he has to maintain control of the football. Right here, his feet are in. Does the ball move when it hits the ground? That's what they're looking for right now. Feet are in, possession of the football. Oh, yes, he squeezed the football. The ball never moved. Two big-time catches by the players for UC Davis. First, on the interception by Olave to not allow the ball to move when it hit the ground, and then by Babb on that play to squeeze the football and maintain control as he's falling to the ground. So a good job to keep his feet in bounds, to make a back shoulder catch, and then squeeze the football as he hits the ground.
Coach Hawkins talks about, we don't have starters, we have contributors. There's a true freshman. Let's see if it stands here.
The rolling of a touchdown is confirmed.
So UC Davis gets the turnover, and they get the touchdown from the freshman to take the lead. O'Rourke, the junior from Rockland, California, makes it a 7-point game, 21-14 Aggies.
Extra point is good.
Doss lined up left, they go right to Babb, the true freshman. UC Davis has the lead here in the third quarter. UC Davis gets a takeaway, and they turn it into a touchdown to grab the lead here. Just underway third quarter from Cheney, Washington. Both teams 10-2. Both teams Big Sky co-champions. A rematch of a game won by the Eagles handily November 10th, but the road team has a momentum right now.
Absolutely. And for UC Davis, this is just what the doctor ordered. Coming out after halftime, getting the early turnover, and turning it into points.
Matt Blair from the 35-yard line, a knuckleball. Merritt picks it up at the 5-yard line. Dennis Merritt hit hard and knocked down at the 20. Good open field tackle right there from Tiger Garcia. How about the drive? They only had to go 28 yards. Olave with a big pick in the middle of that defense.
Well, a good job by Olave to read the quarterback Barrier's eyes and squeeze the football, although it hit the ground, and not lose control. And here, the back shoulder throw. Babb does a great job of squeezing it, not allowing it to move, and keeping his feet in bounds.
Six plays, to go those 28 yards as Eastern Washington now trailing. They'll go to the air with Berrier into Webster's hands. Bounces off one guy, run out of bounds. Far side flag comes in now. Bland over there with Olave to run him out, but a flag right after that tackle.
And Aaron Duncan continues to do a good job on the outside, fighting through the blockers as they try and block him on the outside.
Holding, number 11 of the offense. Half the distance to the goal, first down.
That's the receiver, Terrence Grady.
10-yard penalty.
Eastern Washington prides themselves in their receivers being able to block, but got the flag that time.
Well, the defensive backs for UC Davis have done a good job of fighting through the blocks and getting up the field on these pass plays, not allowing these receivers to get north and south.
First and 16 after the catch and then the mark off, and they'll run it with McPherson straight ahead. Gets to the 15-yard line. Second down and 15 coming up. Terrell Cloud, the 280-pounder from Palmdale, California, on the stop.
And Terrell Cloud has been muscling the offensive line for Eastern Washington throughout the afternoon. He's 6 feet 280. He's using his center of gravity very well to stay below the offensive lineman.
Time for Berrier, and he spots his target for a first down. Johnny Edwards, a sophomore from Pasadena, moves the sticks. Just his 13th catch of the year, 24-yard pickup.
And when you give Berrier time, he's able to find receivers down the field. You see the zone, you see man on the outside. A good job by Berrier finding the receiver, Johnny Edwards.
From the 39 now. They'll run it with McPherson, cuts it upfield, puts his head down. He's just a blue-collar guy to the 47-yard line. Not flashy, not fancy. He's a north-south guy, and he did a good job cutting it back.
And you see Eastern Washington lining up on the football. They've got something going. They want to make sure they keep that defensive personnel for UC Davis in the ball game to try and tire those guys out.
McPherson left, cuts it up. First down inside the 45. And McPherson putting together a big game on the ground. He's nearing 100 yards rushing.
When you've got something going offensively, you want to keep it going. You see right here, he hands the ball off to McPherson. He's able to get up the field and break would-be tackles. That's what you've got to do if you're Eastern Washington. Continue to feed the beast.
They go to Merritt this time. And Merritt, trying to get to the edge, has run out of bounds at the 37. A pickup of 6.
And when I say feed the beast, I'm talking about the three running backs, Custer, McPherson, Pierce. Those are the three best offensive players outside of the quarterback on this team. So you want to get them the ball, allow them to make plays in open space.
And they're ramping up the tempo. You called it earlier, second and four now. Play action this time for Berrier. Goes to the sideline. Boston with the catch. Olave stays right with him. Good tackle from the corner, who has had a big game here in the second game of the playoffs for UC Davis.
And look at the defenders, all their hands on their hips. But a good job by the defense to stay at home. Berrier went with the pump fake. Nobody went for it. I see defenders for UC Davis right now with their hands on their hips. Those guys are a little bit gassed because of the fast pace of this offense. Let's see if this has an effect.
You see the third down numbers. They need three to pick this one up. They shuttle into the hands of Merritt, trying to get to the edge. Bland won't let him do it. Montel Bland running him down. It's fourth down.
And a good job by the defense to play your role. They did not get pressured, but you cannot go east and west against a defense that has speed. You see Bland able to get to the outside, beat the back to the outside, did not allow him to plant that inside foot and get north and south.
Redshirt freshman from Modesto has had a big game at that linebacker spot as we're under 9 minutes to go here in the third quarter. Amane Modise awaiting this punt, standing back at his 6. Alco Bendez, first team all Big Sky punter, gets the kick away, end over end. Fair catch made at the 7-yard line for Modise. Midway through the third, Aggies at the ball, and they lead by a touchdown. Against Northern Iowa at home last week, leading Eastern Washington. These teams, Big Sky co-champions, they have a 7-point advantage here. Aggies have the football back in the lead, starting this series from the 8-yard line. Mayer. Gonna hand it off to Gilliam. trying to cut it up and gets to the 9-yard line. Gilliam, over 100 yards, has two touchdown runs, both coming in the second quarter. As you look at the offenses, and we highlighted this coming in, high scoring teams, defenses have stepped up, and we've kind of settled into a flow here. Teams relying on the run game a little bit more.
Well, you want to run clock, you want to eat up yards, you want to get positive plays, fall forward type of offense right now.
Look at Gilliam's numbers. This is his third time over 100 yards this season. They send Livingston in motion. Hand off Gilliam, trying to cut it up. Good job swarming to the football. Josh Lewis was in there. Tioli also involved in the play.
And a good job by the defensive line to get pressure up the field. They're not allowing the offensive line to get pushed. The defensive backs have to come downhill. Now, this is a play where you would think that they would throw the football, and they caught Eastern Washington in the last ball game with run plays.
Mayer looking for Doss. He has it. Grabs it at the 44. They go to the All-American, and he delivers. Tucker on the coverage, and he couldn't deal with a big frame on that far sideline.
Well, when you've got man coverage on the outside, and you've got Keelan Doss running down the field, throw it up in the air because he's going to go and get it. Once again, Doss high points the football. He squeezes it, brings it to his body, and does not allow Tucker to pull it out at the end. Great job by Doss.
32-yard pickup, and they've got it now at the 43-yard line. Look at the numbers, already over 100 yards for Doss. He's gone over 107 times this season, 19 in his career. Gilliam straight ahead. And they'll take that every time. A good gain up to the 49, close to 5.
And because UC Davis is running the ball effectively, that's going to bring more Eastern Washington defenders inside the box. You'll get more opportunities if you're Mayer to go down the field to your big play receiver, Doss, because he'll have man coverage on the outside.
Six officially on that carry, second and four from their own 49 now. Mayer looking for the call from the sideline. Bunch formation to the right side of that line of scrimmage. Doss is over there. They'll pitch it right. Gilliam makes a man miss, turns it upfield. And he gets a positive gain to the 49. He turned nothing into something. Kreiner, the safety on the tackle.
And that shows you the special ability of Gilliam. Mitchell Johnson, number 94, was up the field. That should have been a tackle for loss. But Gilliam's ability and his elusiveness is what made that play.
This is a third and a couple. Gilliam, hit in the backfield and dropped for a loss. Great job by Ojo. He blew that play up, the strong side linebacker.
And because Ojo got penetration, Gilliam was not able to press the line of scrimmage. You see right there, he has to cut and bounce it to the outside because Ojo came up the middle. The guards and his tackle have to do a better job of picking up these linebackers when they're coming downhill, especially in obvious running plays.
Mojo Ojo, they call him. He gave him Mojo at the right time there as they'll force a punt from Daniel Whelan. Webster standing back inside his 10, awaiting it, end over end. Calling for the fair catch and makes it at the 18-yard line.
Kimball Webster with the fair catch at the 18-yard line. The Eagles will take over.
So Eastern Washington, after that 31-yard punt, they have had ups and downs. They've had two long drives, but they've hurt themselves in a lot of ways, and maybe leaning too much on the passing game.
Well, let's see what the outcome of this game is, but I think that UC Davis wasted an opportunity on that drive with that long pass play to Keelan Doss. They had the defense on their heels, but they allowed the defensive line to get pressure. Now, can UC Davis's defensive line get pressure once again on Barrier and not allow him to get up the field with the football?
Here's McPherson straight ahead for a couple to the 21-yard line. Again, the mantra, as Parenteau got that last stop, run the ball for yards, and we believe we can throw it for miles. That really hasn't transpired for this Eastern Washington offense.
Well, one of the things that Eastern Washington wanted to do coming to this ball game was get 5 yards a carry to make UC Davis respect the run, which would open up the RPO in the play-action game.
We're going to throw it here on second down. Barrier over the middle. And that will be Grady. He'll be short of the stick. They're going to mark his forward progress at the 28-yard line. It'll bring up a third down and about a yard.
You see Berrier right here. He looks to the outside. He doesn't see what he likes. He's able to get the ball down the field. A good job squeezing the ball inside to his receiver, Grady, who's able to get positive yards to put them in third and short.
Grady split out to the left side, and we have a penalty flag coming in here.
They had 12 men on the field. They broke the huddle with 12 men.
Illegal formation on the offense. 12 men in the formation. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Well, that's a crusher. You have a third and one. Now you're in third and six.
Penalty takes the ball back to the 23-yard line. And third and six for the Eagles.
Quick math here, Forrest. I count 11 right there.
But I think we didn't see the player that was running off the field prior to us getting that picture right there. So they had 12 because you don't see the coaching staff arguing about it for Eastern Washington. And that's just something you cannot have happen on third and short.
This changes the dynamic here quite a bit. Third and six. Berrier rolling right. Throwing on the run. Looking for Webster. Too tall with that one. And they'll have to punt it away. Olave on the coverage.
And I think Webster heard number 16, Aaron Duncan, coming across, and he had alligator arms on that play. He didn't want to reach up, and you've got to give it up for the team on that play. Webster, you've got to go up and try and make that catch.
So the Aggies should get good field position out of this. Roldan Alco-Bendez, one of the 10 finalists for the Fred Mitchell Award, the FCS level for kickers who perform on the field and off the field in community service, will kick this one from his 10-yard line. It's a good one. Odise called for a fair catch, and he makes it at the 28-yard line. Excellent putt from Alco-Bendez. 51 yards. Eastern Washington football, then the head man, the head coach of this Eagles program, Aaron Best. He was a great offensive lineman in the late 90s for the Eagles. Honorable mention All-America. Transitioned from his playing days to becoming an assistant coach under Bo Baldwin. Moved to the head coaching ranks and the Big Sky co-coach of the year. It seems like the perfect fit here in Cheney.
Absolutely. He came back home. And you got to love it. As a former offensive lineman, I love to see my offensive line brethren get opportunities.
I love seeing you give love to those offensive linemen with your comments. And you love what they bring to the table. They go to Crawford. The Aggies do on first down. And Crawford bumped out of bounds by Kreiner. At the 20, make it the 33-yard line, good gain on first down.
Well, offensive linemen need to get more credit. They are the only position on the field that every play is designed for you to go hit somebody.
Aggressive bunch. They have a mix of veterans and young guys in there. Here's Mayer now with a deep drop. Deep ball, looking for Doss. Tipped and almost intercepted. Double coverage back there, and for a moment, Anthony Smith thought he had a pick, the freshman playing that deep safety.
Well, Doss had the defender beat, but Mayer did not put enough on the football. If he leads him, Doss is scoring a touchdown on this post route. But a good job by the defender, Zuzi Webster, to get his hands up in there and knock it out. And almost a turnover with Smith coming across.
Doss checks off the field here for this third and four.
And look for Gilliam out of the backfield if they can get the matchup they like.
He goes to Harrell, short of the stick. Did he get the forward progress? Maybe he did. They're going to give him the forward progress and the first down. Cup on the tackle. Good to see Harrell back out there after a foot injury in the first half.
To the 38-yard line,
first down. And Mayer had two places he could have went with the football. He went to Harrell, but he also had Gilliam coming out of the backfield.
Crawford in motion here, and they'll go back to the run game with Gilliam, who stumbles out of the gate and goes down right at the line of scrimmage, the 38-yard line. Johnson there on the tackle.
And that's got to be the fifth or sixth snap that I've seen Mayer pick up off the ground and maintain control. The center has to do a better job of snapping the football to Mayer. Too often I see him getting the ball, gathering it. Watch right here. He's gathering it low, You cannot put your quarterback in that position because it messes up the timing of running plays.
You wonder if the cold conditions are affecting the snapping from Connor Pettick, the center here. By the way, that's 7 carries, 11 yards, the last 7 carries for Gilliam. He has not been as effective as he was in the first half. On second and long, Mayer behind his intended receiver, Crawford, that time.
Passing complete from Mayer.
And I think what Mayer has to do is look where the pressure's coming from. If you see where the pressure's coming from, go to that area. Because when you've got a corner blitz, that means the safety has to roll up and try and cover that receiver. If the receiver sees the corner blitzing, he needs to turn around and make himself available and make himself a big target for his quarterback.
Let's see what the Eagles dial up here in terms of their blitz scheme. Third and 10. Making a lot of noise here at the Inferno. Five on the line of scrimmage, and a flag comes in. Timeout before the flag, it appears. Yeah, they get the timeout. The back judge threw a flag, but the timeout called first by Coach Hawkins.
And this is a big play because you want to extend the drive. You want to take more time off the clock. The more time that comes off the clock, the more pressure that starts to build for this Eastern Washington ball club.
ESPN's coverage of the FCS Championship continue next weekend. Semifinal coverage on ESPN2. For more information, go to NCAA.com, the official online home for all 90 NCAA championships. Third and 10. If you're the Aggies here, it would behoove you to go Doss's way if you can, right? He just makes good things happen.
Well, you've got Harrell back in the ballgame. You've got Gilliam out of the backfield. That's a matchup I think they'll look for to see. If they can get Gilliam on a wheel route, see who's covering him. If you get a linebacker on Gilliam, I think that's the route you go if you can't get to Doss on the outside. I expect Eastern Washington to bracket Doss with the safety over the top.
They have Doss in the slot. They're 5 for their last 7 on third down. This would be a tough one, though, 3rd and 10. Mayer. Crawford. No. Try to go back shoulder with that one. He's out of bounds. Lewis on the coverage.
That was a great effort by Crawford. Mayer put the ball just a bit outside where he could not stay in bounds.
Oh, great effort.
I don't know. I think they need to go back and look at that play because Crawford squeezed the football. His right foot was in bounds, and the ball did not move.
You just need 1 foot down. They get the snap away. Here's Whelan from the 30-yard line. Webster's going to let it hit at the 30. And it'll roll inside the 20. Gets a big roll for the Aggies and out of bounds to the 11-yard line. How about this Crawford effort after that 51-yard punt?
Well, I think that was a missed opportunity for UC Davis right here. He's got control of the football right there. Control of the football. Left foot is down. The ball never moved. I think that's a reception. That's something they should have went back and challenged because he caught that football. The ball did not move. He had possession of the football when his left foot was down.
Well, let's see if that play ends up being big down the stretch here. 1:35 to go, third quarter. Eagles have the football back from their 11-yard line. Berrier over the middle. Tight end has it. It's Belk, who's had a big game. Had a touchdown grab in the first half, and he has a first down here. Ryan Perito, the senior from Anthem, Arizona, on the stop.
And a good job by Berrier. He allowed Montel Bland, the middle linebacker, to release out to the flat, and the tight end with a delayed release in the middle of the field.
McPherson straight ahead. And McPherson to the 26. Jordan Franklin on the stop, the nose tackle up front.
Second down and 6 at the 26.
The tight end, by the way, Belk, 5 catches, 73 yards. He's been a weapon for this Eagles offense.
And with the ball on this hash mark, it makes it difficult for UC Davis to get subs in.
McPherson trying to cut it back and gets it to the 29. Third down and 3 coming up. Roland O'Kanzi, the junior end on the stop.
Can UC Davis get another stop on third down?
They're going to bring their third down personnel onto the field now. Okanzi, one of those checking off along with Parento. Pressure coming. Guerrier stepping up. He's hit by Baumgart, and down he goes with help from Franklin. The pressure from the Aggies will force a fourth down.
And you see what UC Davis is doing. They're showing one front, but they're bringing more than they show prior to the snap. A good job by Baumgart to get pressure and flush the quarterback up. Berrier tried to step up in the pocket, but they had that covered up. 5-on-5, offensive line, you've got to win that battle.
Third quarterfinals in the FCS playoffs, UC Davis 21.
So that is the final play of this third quarter, and UC Davis doing the only scoring. They get an interception, they turn it into six, and they have a touchdown advantage. This catch by Babb, the difference. Aggies, Eagles with a trip to the FCS semifinals. One quarter to go from Cheney. We start the fourth quarter at this FCS quarterfinal. The winner will host the Maine Black Bears in the FCS semifinals next weekend. Big second quarter for UC Davis. They trailed 7-0 early, have not trailed since. They have the lead and a chance to get excellent field position here. Roldan Alco-Bendez to punt it away from his 15-yard line. Imani Modise will let it hit at the 37, picks it up on the hop at the 30, makes a man miss, trying to sidestep another guy, and goes down at the 36-yard line. 43-yard punt, and good field position for Mayer and company. Well, Coach Hawkins said we need to be the best version of ourselves, and they have been, and they're really good when they have the lead heading into the fourth.
8-0 when leading after the third quarter. You can't depend on that, though. You've got to continue to play football if you're UC Davis. I think you run Gilliam a little bit more with this drive. You try and get your ball to your big play receiver on the outside, Doss, but you want to move the ball down the field. You want to definitely get a score, but you want to also eat up some clock. Put pressure on this Eastern Washington ball club.
Gilliam with 119 yards and a couple touchdowns. Doss has been the go-to guy in the passing game. 7 catches for 103. They'll throw it to Gilliam in the flat. Gang tackled after maybe a yard pickup on the near side at the 37. Kettner Cup's been everywhere. He's in on that tackle.
Well, this is what you want to do. Once again, a low snap. But Mayer's able to pick it up and get the ball to the outside. But they're able to get to Gilliam before he's able to get going. And something that should be noted, we talked about Gilliam's first half with all those yards. When you take out Teron Thomas, their second back, now more pressure's on Gilliam, so he doesn't have as much rest. You don't have the interchangeable backs now.
Yeah, Gilliam has 19 carries, 6 receptions. He's been a workhorse. And they'll go to him again here. Slanting left across the 40. Good run up to the 43-yard line as he puts his head down. Ojo on the stop, third and manageable coming up.
What's special about Gilliam is his ability to get small and get through small cracks. You see right here, he's able to squeeze through that crack, turn his body sideways, and then continue to barrel and fall forward.
They've got the pistol look this time and three receivers to the left. In motion is Harrell. They'll pitch it to Gilliam. Does he get there? No, he's run out of bounds. Cup was there, Josh Lewis was there. Big stop for the Eagles defense.
And a good job by Chris Ojo to get up the field. Watch number 58, flash. He gets up the field, which forces Gilliam to bounce it to the outside. He could not turn up the field. See 58 right here. He got up the field, which made Gilliam keep going to the outside. He was never able to plant that inside foot and get up the field.
Ojo has been active as Simba Webster already has a punt return for a touchdown this season, awaits this punt from Daniel Whelan. He's going to call for a fair catch, and he makes it at the 17-yard line. Eagles trail by 7 in this rematch of Big Sky Co-Champs. Eagles trail by a touchdown. Eric Berrier a little bit frustrated right now.
Well, when you look at what's happening, they're getting pressure on him. They're not allowing him to get outside the pocket. And after the last drive, you see him come to the sideline. He's shaking his head. He's frustrated. And that's what you have to do. The only loss he's had this season, Weber State was able to do the same thing. keep him pressured, keep him rattled, not allow him to get out to the outside and use his athleticism.
Last eight possessions, five punts, an interception. They do have that 91-yard touchdown drive. They'll go on the ground here. Straight ahead, it's McPherson, and a big gain for number 20, who has played very well. He picks up a first down. McPherson is over the century mark. Ryan Parenteau on the tackle.
And this is Eastern Washington football. Man on man, the guards are getting up to the second level, covering up the linebackers, and when you're able to do that, you're able to get positive yards.
This is Williams in motion behind the backfield, and Berrier goes over the middle, caught by Webster, and he has a first down to the 49. Their go-to receiver, Duncan, on the stop. He's been held in check, but for the most part, 19-yard pickup.
Moving parts, moving parts. When you've got an aggressive defense, and you've got moving parts, they're going to react. You see the linebacker in the middle, Montel Bland, react to the motion in the backfield, which opens up the middle of the field.
Now Berrier to the sideline, and a short gain. Grady will pull it in. They'll mark him out at the 47. Pick up a four. King on the coverage.
Now, Eastern Washington has gotten some positive plays throwing the football, but don't get away from your identity, which is rushing the football.
12 minutes to go here. A trip to the FCS semifinals, and a date with Maine is on the line. Berrier, pressure coming from Moy. Going to step up and run it. And positive yardage inside the 43. Third short coming up. Montel Bland gets him from behind.
And pressure from the outside makes Berrier step up in the pocket. You see Mason Moy able to get pressure from the outside. Bland is able to make the tackle. He hurt himself on that play, but he's able to get him down. That's what you have to do. I'm sorry, not Bland, but Terrell Cloud got hurt on that play. But that's what you have to do. You've got to get pressure on Berrier. Don't allow him to sit back there and pick you apart. I thought Eastern Washington should go back to the running game. That is their bread and butter. They've had some success passing the football on this series, but you can't forget what got you here.
162 passing, 149 rushing for the Eagles in this one. Looking at a third and a couple here.
And look at the defenders all up in the box. So if you get the ball to a back and he gets to the second or third level, there's not many defenders to bring him down.
Couple tight ends in the backfield, and the pistol, they'll go to McPherson. And maybe a yard. He needed the 41. Did he get there?
And McPherson with a 41-yard.
Oh, they gave him the forward progress. That's a first down.
And he got a great spot on that play.
Coach Best, former offensive lineman, he's got that mindset. He'd love to just run it between the tackles here and establish that dominance. It hasn't been easy against UC Davis. Berrier, handoff to McPherson, wants to throw it. Wide open is Merritt at the 20. Merritt inside the 10 and run out of bounds. A little trickery from the Eagles. Running back to running back. Garcia finally runs him out.
And they've been setting this play up the whole afternoon. You see the jet sweep action. You see guys coming around. Everyone's paying attention. He hands it off, and then he looks back across the field to find his teammate Merritt streaking down the sideline. A great job not getting too excited and putting too much on the football. Too often when you've got a guy wide open and you've got a person throwing the football that's not used to throwing it, they put a little bit too much on it. A good job on that pass play.
First and goal from the eight. They run McPherson to the right side, and he drags a tackler down near the five. It'll be a second and goal from there. Oh, we've seen a wide receiver pass from UC Davis, a running back to running back pass from Eastern Washington.
And right now, Coach Aaron Best, I think he's going to go with the offensive lineman's mentality. This is four down territory. He wants to get a touchdown. You don't want to settle for a field goal when you're this deep in the red zone.
They go that pistol look again, running back behind the quarterback on a second and goal. Handoff. No, Berrier going to keep it, and he is in for the touchdown.
Great decision by Berrier on the RPO. He read Baumgart coming down on the inside, and he was able to get to the outside with that speed and get to the end zone.
That is seven rushing touchdowns in essentially half a season after taking over for the injured All-American Gage Gubrud. What a talent he is. Just a sophomore from Inglewood, California. And now penalty flags come in before the PAT.
False start. 69 to offense. 5-yard penalty. Retry the down.
It's Will Graham. Important extra point here. And this will make it a little bit more difficult for Alco Bendez. For the tie. Got it. We're tied at 21.
And watch number 6, Bumgard, on this play. Berrier does a good job of reading him. Bumgard thinks he's going to make a big play. You see him break down. But oh, the ball is not in his hand. Berrier has the football. He gets to the end zone. A big, big play on the RPO. A good decision by Berrier to tie the score at 21.
6 to go. A trip to the FCS semifinals and a date with the Maine Black Bears is on the line. A big running back to running back pass from McPherson to Merritt, setting up the score. A Berrier touchdown run. 8 plays, 82 yards. They've had 3 drives of 80 plus to get their scores in this one.
Well, UC Davis had their opportunities and they did not take advantage of it. There were 3 different drives in the second half. They could have put more points on the board. They did not. Now we've got a tie ball game. Let's see which defense can stand up and continue to get stops and which offense can make the big plays.
A personal foul penalty, they tack it on and it's added on this kickoff, which is from the 50-yard line. Bounced up there to Modise, and that allows the cover team to get down there quickly, and they drop Modise at the 15-yard line. Excellent coverage from the Eagles as Anthony Smith was there.
And on the last drive, the thing that Berrier did a good job of is getting the ball and spreading it around. You see McPherson to Merritt on this play. That was the big play of the drive. But watch Berrier on the touchdown. He keeps it in the back's belly to the last minute. And you see Bumgard thinking he's going to make the play in the backfield. And Berrier gets around the edge for the easy score.
And they're loud here at the Inferno looking for a stop. And a penalty flag for the back judge.
Delay on the offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
You cannot have a delay coming off of a kickoff. You've got to know what the play is. You've got to get in there. You've got to line up. That is discipline. Coach Hawk and his staff are very disappointed in the offense right now.
This is why you work so hard, though, to have the home crowd with you. Crawford on an end around. Gets him that real estate back across the original line of scrimmage to the 16-yard line. 3rd and 9 coming up. Nick Forstell, the end on the stop.
And Jake Mayer once again is able to pick up a low snap. You've got to hope that this does not have a negative effect on this team moving forward. That's got to be the 7th or 8th low snap that Jake Mayer has been able to get down and pick up and get the ball to the back coming across.
Das split wide to the bottom of the screen. You can see his helmet. Pressure coming. Incomplete. Through the hands of Harrell. And now it's a 3rd and 9. Cup on the coverage.
And Jake Mayer is ID where he wants to go with the football. He cannot stare his receivers down. You see right there, he's staring the receiver down, which allows the defender to read his eyes. Kettner Cup is reading Jake Mayer's eyes. You've got to look off the defenders.
Mayer 2 for his last 6 passing, staring at a 3rd and 9. They rush 4 with the blitz. Pass is delivered on the money for a 1st down. It's Doss to move the chains.
And what a job by Mayer to stand in the pocket. He had pressure coming all around him. The offensive line did a good job, the tackles, of keeping the width of the pocket and the guards at center, allowing him to step into that throw and get it to his big play receiver down the field.
8 catches for 116 for Doss. They go back to the ground game now. And Gilliam, and he gets a couple yards to the 31-yard line. Ledbetter on the stop. the defensive tackle. Talking a couple Peyton candidates, hooking up on that previous pass play. Mayer to Doss.
Well, as a quarterback, you've got to be fearless when they're bringing pressure and stand tall, because if you do, you will be able to find the open receiver.
They rush four. Crawford. Short gain. Marked out at the 32. Ojo was there to cover that real estate. Third down is here.
And I'd like to see Crawford cut that back up the field. You've got to get the first down. You're not trying to save time. You're trying to get yards. You've got to play tough man football and turn that up the field as opposed to running out of bounds.
Coach Hawkins trying to keep the football here as we're near the 8-minute mark. Doss is to the left of the formation, split up near the far sideline. Split out. Mayer looking that way. He wants Doss. Back shoulder throw. It's off the mark. Fourth down.
And if Mayer throws the ball where Doss can make a play on it, they would have gotten an interference call because the defender never turned around to locate the football. He played through Doss. Look at the defender. He's not looking for the football. He's looking at Doss. If the ball is thrown to the inside where Doss can make a play on it, they will get the interference call on that play.
So the Eagles will get the football back. Daniel Whelan standing at his 18. Webster, a dangerous return man at his own 33, awaits it. And he did not hit it well off the side of his foot. It'll take a backwards hop, and this will give the Eagles excellent field position. They'll mark it at the 38-yard line, just a 31-yard punt.
And I'm not going to hold that against him because he's had some really good punts this afternoon. You want to get a good punt on that play. It wasn't as great as the ones that he's had in the past, but it wasn't as bad as it could have been.
Well, we talked about how important Eric Berrier is to this Eastern offense. You see his passing numbers, not big yardage throwing it, but he's been efficient.
And the one thing that UC Davis cannot allow Berrier to do is get outside the pocket.
Looking to throw it here. Steps up. Deep ball downfield for Boston. In stride, he makes the catch. It'll be first and goal for Eastern Washington. He beat Olave, and they're knocking on the door. 55 yards.
And number 20, Vincent White, was tracking the football. He turned around, he located the football. He just did not make a play on it when it arrived.
That is a clutch throw from a sophomore in a big game. From the 7, play action to the sideline. Webster, touchdown, Eagles. They're in front.
Too easy. I thought on that play, number 20, Vincent White could have made a play on the football on the big pass. And you see they're able to get the ball to the outside. You see right here, Berrier has all the time that he needs to deliver a strike down the field. Look at 20, he's tracking the football. You've got to make a play on it. And then on the next play, Berrier is able to hit his back on the outside to get the easy score.
And the extra point is blocked. There is a flag down. Alco Bendez has his extra point blocked. And let's see if that stands here.
How big would this be if this play stands?
Bland. Montel Bland blocked it.
Looks like they're going to get another opportunity to attempt the extra.
Offsides on the defense. Number 20. Half the distance to the goal. Replay the try.
Vincent White was offside.
And Vincent White has had a bad series right now. He gives up the big play and now he's offsides.
So we'll retry this. Alco Bendez, one of the top kickers at the FCS level, has missed just one extra point all year. Trying to make this a 7-point game. Got it. 28-21. Berrier stepping up. First a touchdown run in this fourth quarter. Then this touchdown pass to Webster. Eastern Washington in front on the red turf at the Inferno. Late in the fourth. Big fourth quarter for Eastern Washington, now leading UC Davis 28-21 with a trip to the FCS semifinals on the line. Sophomore Eric Berrier has been sensational, 20 of 23 passing. He's completed 9 of his last 10, and now the Aggies in catch-up posture with Modise awaiting this kick from Slider. It's going to squib it. It's not going to give Nomani a chance to return it. It bounces off of White, and it's recovered by UC Davis, and this is Christian Skepteris, and he takes it up to the 40-yard line. Some anxious moments right there from the return team.
And I don't like the squib kick because you give UC Davis great field position.
Berrier was big on that last drive.
Well, we saw Berrier look frustrated in the third quarter, but you see him able to get the ball down the field right here. He hits his receiver in stride, Boston, and then right here, he does a good job with the ball fake and is able to get the ball out to Simba Webster, and nobody covers him on the outside.
Short field now for Dan Hawkins Bunch. The Aggies from the 40-yard line, trailing by a score now. First time they've trailed since 7-0 in the first quarter. Mayer, incomplete. Kind of come up with it was a sliding Crawford at second and 10.
And that's a dangerous throw by Mayer because he's throwing it across the field. You've got defenders sitting back in that zone. You have to be careful making those throws.
Big Sky Offensive Player of the Year. He's had some monster games. 478 passing against Sacramento State. 446 in a win over an FBS team, San Jose State, the start of the year. You can see the numbers. Gilliam, maybe a yard, and that's it. Third and 9, staring the Aggies in the face. Cup on the tackle.
And Cup does a good job of filling the gap. Watch Cup number 40 fly up in there. Boom, right there. That's exactly how you're taught. Put a shoulder pad on the ball carrier and drive him back.
The line to make the midfield strike.
And Doss is down at the bottom of the screen. If they see man coverage on the outside, does Mayer try and go to his big play receiver?
There's Doss. There he is, bottom of the screen. They'll run it with Gilliam, and he loses yardage back to the 39. Interesting call there. Jim Townsend, the junior end, swallows him up.
Well, these are the plays Coach Aaron Best said that they caught them with last time they played. And obvious passing downs, they hit him with the run. They tried to do it on this play once again, but Gilliam's not able to get going because Eastern Washington brought pressure up the field.
Under 6 minutes to go. Simba Webster standing back at his 24. Whelan gets off a booming punt. And the fair catch called for and made at the 12-yard line. 5:39 to go. Eagles up by 7 here in Cheney.
I'm out of the field. 5:39 remaining.
To him in the vicinity of the 25-yard line right now.
And on that play, he got hit from the side. He did not see the defender coming, and his head bounced off, the back of his head bounced off the turf.
Sitting up now, the sophomore from Stockton, California, who Dan Hawkins singled out as just a tremendous kid. Former walk-on. He says he's going to be one of those guys that's a CEO, mayor, governor, president someday. And you can say that about a lot of these UC Davis kids. Great kids. And we hope for the best for number 16 here.
This has been an extremely physical football game.
That's a good sign. You've seen many of those through your years playing football.
And it's so awesome to see him be able to get up and walk off the field with the help of the UC Davis medical staff.
Fans against the game would like to thank their official equipment supplier, Wilson, for their
tough
support.
Heart of a lion, Coach Hawkins says about Aaron Duncan. They're starting safety. And they need to stop now with 5:39 to go. They only have two timeouts remaining. They had to burn one. At Eastern Washington, if you're an offensive lineman now and you've been there, this is where you want to control the line of scrimmage, get some first downs, and burn some clock.
Well, you've got to accept the challenge. This is what you lift weights for. This is what you flip tires for in the offseason. This is what you run up and down mountains and hills for. This is what you do all the extra stuff in preparation for the season for, to accept the challenge right now and win at the point of attack.
From the 13-yard line, they'll hand it off to McPherson. He's hit in the backfield and he lost yardage. Boy was in there. He's been active throughout the FCS playoffs.
And you see them with the counteraction pulling, but they get penetration, the defensive line does, which does not allow the offensive lineman to turn up in the hole and clear a path.
Loss of two as we near the 5-minute mark. Hand off again. They play it close to the vest. A conservative call with McPherson, burning some clock. Jordan Franklin on the stop. Now a third and long coming up.
Well, they tried to pull the right guard, Caleb LeVay, but they once again got penetration on the left side of that offensive line. A good job by Terrell Cloud on the inside to get penetration up the field.
Now, if you're the Eagles, you don't want to take a lot of chances down here, back near your own goal line. You've got the lead, under 5 minutes to go.
Well, your defense has played well enough where you can feel confident about them. But you know if you get a first down, you put more pressure.
And he wanted to hand it off, but Berrier in some trouble, and he goes down. Is he in the end zone? He keeps his footing. He's out of the end zone somehow, and they're going to mark him down. Let's see, at the 3-yard line. That was dangerously close to 2 points as Mason Moy was in the backfield.
And coaches always talk about high and tight. Berrier is dangerously having the ball. You cannot have the ball out like that. You know you've got pressure. Squeeze the football. You see his elbow go down right there at the 1-yard line. A good job by the officials to call that down. But Berrier was flirting with danger on that play. You've got to get rid of the football or take the sack. You cannot continue to drop back. He almost gave up a cheap 2 points.
How did he get out of that? He was in the clutches of Baumgart. Let's take another look here.
Well, he's so fleet of foot, but you see right there, watch the elbow go down. Right there, you see the ball almost came out. Right there, he's down. But the ball almost came out. That would have been disaster for Eastern Washington.
UC Davis, a season-high 11 tackles for loss. They have been active, and they're going to force the punt here. Line of scrimmage, the 3-yard line. And a golden opportunity, and this is where you count on one of the top punters nationally, Alco Bendez. Modise standing at the Eagles' 43-yard line. Alco Bendez gets the kick away. It's a liner, hits at the 35, and hit is Modise, and a flag goes down. They didn't give him a chance to field that ball, and a penalty flag is down after a 40-yard punt.
Lack of discipline. You cannot have that happen. You give up an additional 15 yards on a short punt.
No fair catch call for, but he was hit before he could get to the ball here.
Can't catch interference. Gets the kicking team. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
And you've got to give him an opportunity to field the football.
The ball hit the ground, so there will be no kick catch
interference. Dennis Merritt, the guy that hit him before the ball got there.
Now you see the Eastern Washington sideline complaining because the ball bounced off the top of his head. The ball bounced off of his head. I would not want to be the officials right now.
The recovery of the receiving team is under review.
The ball bounces off the top of his helmet, and it's going to be interesting what this call is. Watch the ball. It bounces off his helmet. It hits the Eastern Washington player first, so it's going to be UC Davis football.
Because it hits Dennis Merritt, they blow the play dead, and the Aggies have the football. That should be the call here.
I tell you what, Trey, I wouldn't want to be the official making this call. And this right now is one of those game-altering calls. This can decide this football game.
One timeout remaining for UC Davis. A quick strike offense, one of the top offenses at the FCS level. Number 7 in points scored, number 3 in passing offense, averaging almost 41 points per game, but they need a touchdown here.
Well, if Eastern Washington gets this ball back, all they've got to do is get 2 first downs, make UC Davis use their timeout, and they can pretty much run the clock out.
What we saw there is that the ball hit the Eagles player first. Mm-hmm. It should be UC Davis ball based on our visual evidence here.
You see Coach Best right there. He knows how big this call is.
Off Merritt's right shoulder pad, then the contact with the returner.
Both coaches realize how big this call is right here for the officials.
After further review, the ruling is there was illegal touching at the 42-yard line by the kicking team before the recovery. Therefore, the ball would belong to UC Davis at the 42-yard line.
They made the correct
call. Reset the clock to 4:05. 4:05.
I think they made the correct call. I don't know if the explanation was correct, but I think it was the correct call. Illegal touching. I'm trying to figure that one out. But once the kicking team touches the ball, it is down. It's down right there.
And now they mark off that penalty yardage to the Eagles' 42-yard line. So 42 yards now separate UC Davis. Touchdown and extra point could square things here.
And if you're Coach Hawkins and you get the touchdown, do you go for 2? Let's put it out there in the atmosphere right now.
Forrest is going to bring it out here with 4:05 to go. Here's Gilliam. After a low snap, gets it to the 40 for a couple yards, and that's it.
And right now, Jake Mayer is the MVP of this ball game because he has continued to pick these low snaps up and not panic, but get the ball to his ball carriers, whether it's on a jet sweep or handing it to Yolanzo Gilliam out of the backfield.
128 rushing for Gilliam. The redshirt freshman has been sensational. Just one timeout to work with. 3.5 minutes on the clock. Das split bottom of the screen. The All-American. Mayer off his back foot, high throw, incomplete, intended for Harrell, who took a pop. Lewis on the coverage.
And you have to wonder if that ankle injury prevented Harrell from getting the burst to explode up and grab that football, because that's a catch that Harrell usually makes, but you see he doesn't have as much burst to get up and squeeze that football. Good attempt by Harrell, but I just don't think he had enough burst to jump up in the air and get high enough to squeeze that football.
They go trips left this time. To the short side of the field. Das in the middle of those receivers. They rush 4. Mayer. Das. He's got it inside the 15. First down, UC Davis. Hayes on the tackle.
And you gotta bump Doss off the line of scrimmage. You can't let him get a free release. You see Doss running down the middle of the field. He finds a soft area and makes himself available for his quarterback. Mayer knew exactly where he wanted to go with the football when he saw Doss get a free release.
28-yard pickup, 143 yards receiving for Doss, the All-American. They go trips to the right side. Doss in motion this time. Mayer knocked down at the line of scrimmage. That looked like that was Keith Moore that got his hand up there, the defensive tackle.
And Kettner Cut was tracking that football, so I don't know if that would have been a positive play. Defensive lineman always taught, if you can't get to the quarterback, when you see him raise up to throw it, you've got to get your hands up and knock it down. I don't know if that would have been a positive play for UC Davis.
The pistol look this time, and now they shuffle Gilliam out of the backfield. They run option, a little pitch to the tight end, Priest. Little shuttle pass, and he's inside the 10. Forstel, the defensive end on the stop. Third down coming up.
And they try to go with a little bit of trickery. You want to force everything to the outside. Try and get your tight end Priest up the middle of the defense. They've had success running the ball against this defense right in between the guards.
They can get a first down without getting into the end zone here. They need to get it near the 3 as we hit the 2-minute mark. Gilliam straight ahead, off tackle now, leaning in, and he's close to the first down. It appears to have it. As we're under 2 minutes to go, it'll be first and goal. Deontay Hayes, the safety on the tackle.
And a good job by number 87, Wesley Priest, on the block right there to allow Gilliam to squeeze up in that seam. Gilliam does a good job of getting skinny, turning those shoulders, and getting up in small seams to get positive yards.
They still have the one timeout left as we hit 1:30 to go in this one. Four cracks at it for UC Davis.
And with one timeout left, they still have an opportunity to run the ball at least once and stop the clock if they don't get the touchdown.
Harrell in motion. Mayer, little shuttle. It's Gilliam. He's in. Touchdown, Aggies. They go to the shuttle pass up the middle of the formation again, and Gilliam has his third rushing touchdown, and they're an extra point away from tying this one up. Or will they go for 2? You talked about it earlier.
Absolutely. And once again, they had an opportunity to run the football. They had success with the tight end Priest running the shuttle pass, and they get the shuffle pass once again, but now to their back.
They are showing that they're going for 2 here.
And I expect this from Coach Hawkins.
Empty backfield. In motion, Gilliam. A pitch to Modise. Can he get there? Yes! The two-pointer is good, and UC Davis takes the lead.
And I don't know why, but I just expected Coach Hawkins to go for 2. He came up here to win this ball game. In the words of Herm Edwards, you play to win the game, not to tie it and go to overtime. A great job on the play call. First, on the shuffle pass right here to your back, who's used to running in between the tackles. Gilliam's able to power his way into the end zone. And here, with the misdirection, getting it to your speedy back, Mo Dice, he's able to get to the outside and get the two-point conversion.
Nomani Modise, the senior from San Lorenzo, California, great returner, but has played some running back. And how about the gadgetry, if you want to call it that, the shuttle pass, first to the tight end to set it up, and then you go to Modise to take the lead.
Well, Modise is so fast, once he was able to break that tackle, because they had an opportunity to tackle him for a loss on that play, but he's able to step up out of that would-be tackle and get to the outside and get to the end zone. What a big play for Coach Hawkins and his coaching staff.
You had a sense that that two-pointer was going to come into play. And still 1:13 to go, and Eastern Washington has 3 timeouts left.
Well, I think if you told Coach Hawkins he would have a 1-point lead with a minute and 13 seconds left, kicking the ball off, can his defense get a stop? I think he'd be happy with having that type of situation.
Merritt will take the touchback. They'll bring it out to the 25-yard line. Here's the first play, the shuttle pass to Gilliam to drop within one.
And watch Modise on this play, right here. He almost got tripped up right there. A good job to continue to run through that would-be tackle by Jim Townsend, who squeezed down number 49 and get to the edge. And once he gets to the outside, there's not too many people that's going to catch him.
The yardage numbers almost equal. The Eagles just need a field goal. They'll start from the 25-yard line. All three timeouts remaining. Berrier in trouble, evades the would-be tackler. Now he's going to tuck it and run. Berrier in the open field. Midfield, and he's out of bounds.
And you talk about a big play. Berrier should have been tackled for the sack, but his ability to avoid tacklers, his feet, something we talked about early in this game, a true dual threat, but his ability to escape would-be tacklers, big, big play for Eastern Washington.
29-yard carry. They're now on the Aggies side of the field with under a minute to go. Berrier navigating, throwing on the run, incomplete, intended for Webster.
And with three timeouts, if I'm Eastern Washington, I'm running the football. But watch Berrier on this play. This should be a sack right here. But he's able to avoid the defender. And once he gets to the outside, you see the footwork, you see the speed. He's able to get down the field 29 yards and get out of bounds to stop the clock.
Second and 10 from the 46. Still have those three timeouts. They'll go a little slip screen. It's Webster inside the 40, and he has a first down. Just shy of the 35-yard line. They're getting close to Alco Bendez range now. Montel Bland on the tackle. And there he is, 15 of 15 in field goals this season.
You've got to make that tackle if you're UC Davis. They had an opportunity to tackle him for a two-yard gain. It ended up being a first down play.
They'll run it here, and it's a big game for McPherson, turns the corner, inside the 10, touchdown Eagles.
With everything that you talk about and see on defense, the key to winning football games is getting back to the basics and making tackles. You cannot reach out there. You've got to make tackles. On the last two plays, that opportunity is to make tackles. Right there, you've got to make that tackle. You cannot allow him to get to the outside, because once you do it, you let McPherson get downhill, you're not going to be able to stop him.
A 35-yard touchdown run to give him the lead. Now they'll go for two here.
30-second timeout.
And a timeout taken by the Eagles. McPherson with 133 yards since the first quarter. This is a big run here as he gets to the edge.
And in a matter of 47 seconds, they're able to get down the field and get a touchdown. Not a field goal, which is all they needed, but a touchdown. And it's all because of broken tackles. You've got to make those tackles.
That is 12 rushing touchdowns for McPherson, who really epitomizes this Eastern Washington program. They talk about EKG, Eastern kind of guys. He's that guy, a Washington kid, blue collar, five 100-yard games. Dan Hawkins now with just one timeout, 26 seconds left, but we have a two-point play here that could loom large as well. And it looks like they're going to go Wildcat here with McPherson taking the direct snap. McPherson looking to throw it, and it's intercepted. Picked off by Olave, and the two-pointer fails. It's a five-point game.
And I'm going to tell you what's interesting. If Olave is able to keep his feet and get to the end zone, now they're only down by 3 points. That was a dangerous, dangerous play by Eastern Washington.
So Coach Best has seen his team battle back. Here's the failed two-pointer.
Right here, if Olave is able to keep his feet and get back down the field, they're only down 2 points. Oh, excuse me, 3 points.
Well, this one is not disappointed. The Big Sky co-champions in a rematch. On November 10th, it was 59-20. Five turnovers were costly for the Aggies. This one, the type of game you expect between two great programs.
And once again, you see the score right here. McPherson, once he gets going north and south, he's a load to bring down. Something to watch for on this kickoff, though. When we talked to Coach Best during the week, he said one of his big things and one of his big concerns was kickoff coverage. So let's see if they can get good coverage. We saw him squib kick early in the fourth quarter. Let's see if they go into squib or they try and get a deep kick.
Odise is the deep man. Martinez is also back. And Slider's going to kick it away over the head of Martinez. And that'll reach the end zone for the touchback. And UC Davis needs to navigate 75 yards in 26 seconds with just one timeout remaining.
I'm going to my big play receiver, Keelan Doss, every single play. If he gets man coverage on the outside, I'm going to him. He's been able to make plays throughout this season. At 6'3", he has a distinct height advantage, a 4 to 5 inch advantage on every defensive back on this ball club for Eastern Washington. So if he's got man coverage on the outside, if they choose to give him a free release, I'm going to him every play.
We're talking about number three, Keelan Doss, two-time All-American, two-time Peyton Award candidate, and a guy that's going to be playing at the next level. There he is, senior from Alameda, California. Mayer steps up, going to run it. Slides down near the 30-yard line. He'd like to save that timeout, but they've got to use it here after that run. 20 seconds to work with. What a game. This has been a lot of fun.
Well, what Eastern Washington is doing, too, they're playing three deep safeties across the field. They're going to keep everything in front of them. If you're Eastern Washington, you cannot allow anybody to get deeper than you are defensively. And you make a play on the football. Don't panic when the ball is in the air and play through the receiver. You've got to play the football.
It's Eastern Washington program, 10 Big Sky titles, 13 FCS playoff trips. We talked about the 2010 National Championship. That's when Aaron Best was an assistant. Now he's a head coach in the playoffs for the first time. Trying to put his mark on this program. Trying to close this one out. Mayer, backside pressure. Down he goes. Jim Townsend with the sack.
And the fumble, ball game.
Eagles recover it, and they can put the finishing touches on this one.
And when you're able to get pressure with three pass rushers, the offensive line had to do a better job. You've got five against three. You've got to be able to block that up and give Mayer the time he needs to try to get down the field. I think when they gave up that touchdown, the offense was just, they tried to come out and get a score, but that just breaks you down when you play so well. But watch here, you've got three pass rushers. They're running the tackle and stunt. The two ends are able to get to the quarterback. You cannot allow that to happen. You've got to be able to block five against three. But the morale of the offense seemed to be down when the defense gave up that touchdown in 47 seconds.
And a defense that has really put their mark on this program. It's been about offense through the years, Cooper Kupp, Vernon Adams and the like, but Townsend to this D, playing very well against one of the top offenses at the FCS level, and they are off to the FCS semifinals where they'll host Maine here next weekend.
And hats off to the UC Davis program, that first time in the FCS playoffs. They played an excellent ball game. They just could not close it out defensively. A great job by Eastern Washington not giving up. A minute and 13 seconds left on the clock. They not only drove the ball down the field, they didn't get a field goal. They got a touchdown to make sure they put themselves in a position to win this ball game.
Sam McPherson, 24 carries, 143 yards and a touchdown. Number 20 was big throughout the course of the game, especially after the first quarter. And Berrier was 21 of 25 passing for 235 and three touchdowns. But McPherson, when you need to run it, they got it done.
Well, McPherson is a downhill runner. You see him fall forward. He barrels through defenders. And when he gets to the outside, he's able to show some speed. He's not the most fleet of foot, but he's just a powerful north-south runner that got it done when he needed to.
Second team all Big Sky, and the celebration starting here. And big news for the FCS playoffs. They will be back at the Inferno to host the Maine Black Bears, the number 7 seed, coming here after upsetting Weber State. And there's only one Big Sky team remaining. It's this Eagles team.
And that should be a very good ball game, because those are two cold weather ball clubs in Maine and Eastern Washington. So the weather doesn't make a difference in that ball game. I'm interested to see this Maine team, who surprised everybody with big wins throughout the playoffs, come up here to face this tough Eastern Washington ball club.
And how about Dan Hawkins and the job he's done in just his second season at UC Davis? Big Sky Co-Coach of the Year, along with Aaron Best, who's celebrating this one. And these two programs are here to stay. We're going to be hearing a lot of these from these teams in the coming years.
And I tell you what I love about Coach Hawkins, you see Coach Best hugging his wife. He's talking to his daughter. He's happy about the win. But Coach Hawkins also is hugging all of his players as they walk off the field, because a lot of these seniors, this is the last time they'll have the opportunity to represent UC Davis. And they did a great job getting this far.
Well, this is a matchup of a newcomer to the FCS playoffs in UC Davis and a fixture in Eastern Washington with their 13th playoff trip. But this is special for this guy, a head coach tasting victory for the second time after all those years as a player and as an assistant.
Absolutely. I love the idea of a coach coming back home and leading his team. He stayed at home. They've done a great job so far. Tough ball game against a familiar opponent, an opponent that understood what it takes to win here. And now they face another tough opponent in this Maine ball club that we saw take out Weber State yesterday. A ball club nobody expected to be where they are in the playoffs, so it makes for an interesting matchup as we look toward the semifinals.
Six-game win streak now for Eastern Washington. And, you know, they've had great teams in the past. You think of Cooper Cup, Bo Levi Mitchell, Eric Meyer, all Peyton Award winners. This team kind of in Best image, a little bit more blue collar, run the ball well, solid defense. It's not just about the passing game and outscoring people. They can beat you in different ways.
Well, the difference maker in this ball game is Barrier. He had a big run to start that drive when it looked like he was going to get sacked for about a 12 to 15 yard loss. For him to be able to break away from the defender and get up the field and also get out of bounds to preserve a timeout that they did not even have to use because of their ability to score in 47 seconds. He was the difference maker in this ball game. We talked about it early. Game-changing plays. That was the biggest game-changing play.
Aaron Best now joins us. Coach, can you put this into words? You've been here as a player, as an assistant, now as a head coach.
I lost.
Go to semifinals. Talk about what's going through your mind right now.
It's awesome. Absolutely awesome to do what we did. Well, these Warriors, I can't say enough. Incredible to be at your alma mater and be able to do this in front of our home fans. This is impressive, and I'm a proud dad. I'm a proud coach. I'm a proud friend of all this these 105 guys.
Coach, I absolutely love the passion that you're showing right now. Talk about your quarterback, Barrier, and the plays that he made time after time when you needed him.
I'll tell you what, I can't smile more than anybody. I didn't see the smile until about that last drive. So I challenged him. I said, you got a field goal. You got three timeouts. Go make this thing happen. And that scramble he had for about 30 just shows you what kind of player he is. He wasn't on tonight in the past arena. But when we need him most, he showed up, and that's what great players do. So nothing's ever perfect around here. If you've been around here long enough to know, nothing's perfect. We embrace adversity. We fight adversity, and we're better because we're in adverse situations.
Coach, you talked about EKG to us, Eastern kind of guy. McPherson kind of fits that, doesn't he, your senior?
Flat out. I mean, I don't know if there's another one out there like him. True warrior, kid that's a true senior. I had the ability to recruit him out of high school personally. He was in our area that I represented, and that kid's a warrior, and he's a better person than a player, just like that EKG mantra. Very much an overachiever in the classroom and on the field.
Well, Coach, I know it's early, but you've got Maine coming in here. You're hosting a semifinal ball game. Did you ever think when this season started you'd be hosting a semifinal ball game to go play for a national championship?
Well, I'll tell you what, the first thing on the order of agenda was to get the first win of the year out of the season, then find our first conference victory, and then stand around here's Big Sky Championships, and that's what we did. We tried it with Weber and this great UC Davis team. I'd be lying to you say if we were hosting that. That's not what we do. We're not looking to host. We're looking to win, get a punching ticket in because we were left out last year, unfortunately, at a 7-4 clip. And here we are now. So we're going to enjoy this one, not worry about that the main team just yet until tomorrow morning.
Coach, go enjoy this with your family and those Eagles over there.
Thank you, man.
All right, Coach Best, a victorious Eagles team winning it in a wild one. 34-29 in a Big Sky rematch of co-champs. This was everything and more here in Cheney.
Everything we thought it would be and more. The defenses came to play, but the offenses shined at the end.
So an FCS semifinal trip is in the cards for Eastern Washington, and they'll be at the Inferno next weekend as they welcome the Maine Black Bears to town. As we take a look at our bracket, North Dakota State, South Dakota State, a Missouri Valley Football Conference rematch, and Eastern Washington and Maine for the right to go to Frisco, Texas.
This should be a great ball game. That Maine team, nobody expected to be there, will show up on the red turf.
Thanks to Forrest Conley. I'm Trey Bender saying so long from Cheney. 34-29, the Eagles win it. To watch this entire game on replay as well as other games on our family of ESPN networks, log on to watchESPN.com or download the ESPN app. This has been a presentation of ESPN. Good night from Cheney, Washington.